I have no idea what we're doing.
Just launch.
There's no, we're live now. We're live. People can watch. Michael Malice sitting right next to me. So let me just start by saying, no verdict tonight in the Kyle Rittenhouse trial. I see people commenting like they thought they're doing this big show because they thought the verdict was going to come in and they're going to break. No. He's shaking his head. Here's what happened. Let me tell you the story. So we're coming down to Austin and we're trying to find good people in Austin to talk to, and Blaire White.
Hi.
So we were like, Lydia just ran out the door. Okay, well, we'll show Blaire White.
Joe and Rogan is in town, and we have the Michael Malice and Luke Radowski and Tim Pool.
Well, so here's what happened. We asked Blaire to come on the show because we love Blaire, and then Alex was like, "Hey, are you guys gonna have? Am I coming on at all?" And we were like, "You know, it'd be really cool if you came on with Blaire White, but we got to make sure Blaire's cool with it."
Of course, I was totally down, and then it kept escalating, and then it was Michael.
So then someone leaked it to Michael, and he was like, "You're having me on the show, right?"
Yeah.
And
it was me. Like, I leaked it to him.
Yeah, shit. Yeah.
I like how he works like, in that we're all asking to come on. Of course we want to come on, Tim. You're great.
But then it's like, I'm thinking, oh man, this is huge. Like, what are we going to do? And so.
And then Joe Rogan calls.
Well, hold on.
You are the worst. Wait. Let him tell his story.
Let me tell his story. We had Drew Hernandez here, who's sitting right here. I don't know what camera works for Drew.
I don't know, Lydia. How do I switch this thing?
You've got a job to do,
hello,
Lydia.
We are all here, and it's amazing.
Okay, so.
Get to work, woman.
It's for me.
Oh, I don't want to throw it across all this stuff.
Pass it in.
Give it to Ian.
Here.
I want to pass.
We're disorganized mess.
Thank you, Lou.
Okay, hold on. I warned everyone this would be a cacophony, loud noise. Okay, so hold on. So Drew, the way it is,
there'll be a lot of people talking.
Drew is here, and I was like, Drew, like, if the verdict comes in, Oh, it's Joe Rogan.
There you go.
What up? Bro, thanks for coming, man. Right
here? You're now podcasting out of an RV, brother.
How the mighty have fallen.
Right on time.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Look at that beautiful bastard,
Joe.
Right, yeah.
The show is about to begin.
Yeah.
We got Alex Jones, Joe Rogan, Tim Pool, Michael Malice, Drew Hernandez. This is it right now.
This is breaking the internet.
Breaking the internet. Everyone needs to share this link now. Share the link.
A dog bit me.
I don't
think so. A dog bit me.
It did.
All right.
What the fuck did you do to that dog?
I misgendered it.
Oh, he did.
All right, so
don't talk about me like that.
Let me wrap this story.
How did the dog bite you?
We try not to swear.
Why?
Suddenly.
We try to be family friendly.
We have limited time with Lord Rogan. Let's hear what he has to say.
Well, so Drew is here.
Yes.
And we were talking like, Drew, if the verdict comes in on the Rittenhouse case, he's an eyewitness. He filmed it. I was like, can you stick around to come on the show? And
saw the whole thing,
Rogan.
He testified in the trial.
It was totally different than the video, right?
What part?
Just kidding.
No, it wasn't. Not at all.
No, that was my point.
When you see people like Anna Kasparian saying, I thought it was a totally different thing.
The footage has been out for like the entire time.
But everybody thought it was a totally different thing.
Because they would also censor the footage. You couldn't block it.
Because the corporate press is the enemy of the people.
Did you see how MSNBC would not show the defense responses? Only
prosecution. Only the prosecution. Well, so we were like, Drew, stick around. And then when this show just became whatever the hell is going on, everyone was like, Tim, did you ask Joe to come on? And I was like, oh, he's got a show. He's a busy guy. And I was like, well, hey, Joe, you want to break the internet? You know, Michael's
really
excited.
We're not breaking the internet, bitch. I'm just showing up at your weird trailer.
remember when I told you, though, I was going to get a van.
It's ridiculous. It's awesome. It really is dope. I love the lighting. I love the fact you have a screen here. It's brilliant, right?
I love it. I want
this
it.
This is amazing.
And I like it.
The screen that, so you can't see it on camera, but the screen we have for everyone to watch the news, like to see the news articles we pull up, rises up from the dress up.
That's very fancy.
Like
I saw that at Hugh
Hefner's hotel. Like at Hugh Hefner's house.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah. So, Joe Rogan in the house.
Alex Jones, ladies and gentlemen, right about basically everything. Finally, it's all coming down. The truth is coming out.
So, Thomas Jefferson was in the Illuminati.
Bunch of demons.
Joe Rogan is the 46th president of the United States.
I smell sulfur.
People are just giving us money.
Oh God, that's how it works, Tim.
I'm already. So it's hot in here.
Listen, it's kind of exciting.
I like it. Let Joe talk.
Isn't it kind of exciting though? Like obviously the world has gone completely into chaos.
Yes.
Isn't it great?
Like we are in this weird position where the mainstream media is almost universally accepted as at least being mostly full of shit.
Mm-hmm.
or partly full of shit.
Totally,
right?
Full of crap.
The most optimistic person says, well, they lie sometimes. Right? That was never the case with Walter Cronkite.
Exactly. Who also lied all the time.
Or was it? Did he lie all the time, but people didn't realize it.
They lie like a crackhead hitting on a crack rock.
Alex, every word they say is a lie, including and the.
Since the beginning.
It's reached new levels of lying, though.
No, we've reached new levels of being able to expose them. They were lied us into the Spanish War in Cuba 100 years ago. Nothing's changed.
That's the truth, right?
Rosebud.
Yes.
Yeah. Gulf of Tonkin, Operation Northwood.
It's always been lies.
They've always
Mass
been lies.
Destruction.
Right. Absolutely. This is the way they do business.
The New York Times refused to report that Germany was targeting Jews.
Exactly.
Because that would be buying into identity politics at the time, because Jews were white, and that's what Hitler said. Jews weren't white.
And the government knew about it, and they covered it up, including the railroads, which they could have stopped, but they decided not to.
Hold on, let me just make one point. There's a book called Buried by the Times. Look it up.
Yep.
And this was how they covered it up, because they didn't want to buy into what Hitler was saying.
How is it now different? You know, if they've been, I think they've been lying the whole time.
Yes.
But how are we now figuring it out? Right?
Well, I'll tell you what's about to happen. They're devaluing the currency on purpose to crash all the world of currencies and bring out the Great Reset.
That's not what we're talking about, Alex.
No,
this is the Build Back Better agenda, Malice.
No, you're asking Malice why it's happening.
You guys gotta learn how to do this.
No, why it's more obvious.
When a guy starts talking, you don't talk over him. Yes. That's how it works.
Do we have a conch?
Yes, Alex.
Do we have a conch?
Yes, we need a
conch to pass around.
Let him talk.
So you think?
Go ahead, Malice. Tell us. No, listen. It's the Great Reset. It's the Great Reset. ResetWars.com. The point is this the Great Reset, and they're plunging the world economy on by design to consolidate control and kill all the major currencies. That's why there's inflation. That's why there's supply chain breakdowns. I'm just telling you, tomorrow's news today, there is a global destruction of the supply chain and the world currencies to bring in a new world currency based on the vaccine passport.
The issue, what they were asking is, you know, has the corporate press gotten worse? And my point is, we have more mechanisms to expose their depravity and malfeasance in real time. For example, if this had been 20 years ago, they would have been in a position not to let this Kyle Rittenhouse video ever see it.
Yep.
Now, if you have some kind of hack journalist with his cameraman, one's wearing a mask, one's not, everyone has got a phone. And all it takes is one person to film it, put on Twitter or Facebook, and then immediately everyone can see it in real time.
Michael, I totally agree with you.
I just sent you a text message with a meme. It's an amazing meme with Alex. You got to look at this. It's one of my favorite memes. It's a you are here meme. It's all the shit that Alex has predicted that's come true and where you are right now.
Let me read it.
Can you get it? Can you get it on your screen?
Not through a text message.
You fucking primitive apes.
Tweet it out.
Post it on
Instagram.
Don't you have a Jamie?
I don't have a Jamie.
I can't do that. I'm sorry.
Well, they'll pull it up.
Wait. I can Facebook it too, can I?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Let me just say this nicely. Everybody's right. I'm obnoxious and I'm horrible and I apologize.
No, that's not what the meme is.
But Michael,
you're right.
Well, thank you, sir.
I'll send you the meme. I know.
I'm saying Malice is trying to talk about how the establishment media is dead. I'm talking about how the establishment's hitting us economically. So he's making a legitimate point. I'm making a separate point about the progenitor of the problems we have.
I think you guys are both true. There is a global awakening, but there's also a drastic escalation when it comes to the Great Reset, the Build Back Better agenda, what Klaus Schwab is having wet dreams about when it comes to enslaving humanity, making people live in pods, making people eat bugs, having them as little paid.
Oh, my God.
Like they're not going.
That's because they're not going down without a fight. So
exactly.
Once the mask is off, you better get whatever you
but
can.
But we win the fight quicker if we know who they are.
Look at that meme. Yeah, can you turn me up? Make that larger. Make that meme larger. Look at that shit.
Pull that
your
up,
TV
Jamie.
Spying on you. Check.
Bohemian.
Elite cabal of sex traffickers. Check. They're turning the frogs gay.
Check.
It's hermaphrodites. It's hermaphrodites, right?
Yeah.
Bohemian Grove, check. Silver iodide, not really sure. Rich people using baby blood, I'm not.
That's
sure.
True. No, it's happening down in Mexico right now.
No, is it really?
Yes, it is. Disgust. People are doing that, yep.
You are here, human monkey chimeras.
Oh, I'm looking forward
which
to
he
that.
Predicted a long time ago.
Well, where's that? Where's the
wait, you're
thing?
Saying the elves aren't real? That's
no,
the,
no, that's next.
Well, the elves
it's
are
like,
real.
This is what
of course
predicted.
They're real.
They're coming next.
In what right, dimension?
So hold on. What is silver iodide?
That's like some shit that kills diseases.
Oh. Yeah, it's true. Yeah,
it's essentially true, but also
now let me
and makes your skin blue.
But I'll point something out. I'll point something out about this meme. The TV's spying on you, Alex. You were pointing these things out because they were happening. The turning the frogs gay—that was atrazine, I believe. That's a pesticide, right? And that was messing with the endocrine systems of frogs, which was causing weird deformity.
I was just covering a Berkeley study, yeah.
But
yeah,
it,
yeah,
it was more turning, changing their gender, and it wasn't making them.
But here's the deal. I'll be here for 5 hours. Joe's got to go to his show.
Then why are you yelling?
That's how he talks normally.
You have a microphone.
That's how he talks normally.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I am the Alex Whisperer.
You should see him in church.
Take the vaccine. Okay, I want to hear what Joe Rogan has to say. Joe's nice to say nice things about me, but Joe's also predicted a lot of stuff that came true.
What did I predict?
You predict? Oh, my God. Have you watched your earlier comedy?
I don't think I... Oh.
Probably not.
Maybe.
Okay, I remember in like 1999, I just met Joe before, like, gone to dinner with him and like this producer I know. And then I go to see him at the Cap City Comedy Club, now defunct. And he goes up and he goes, let me tell you what's going to kill the corporate media in Hollywood and everybody. It's going to be the internet. It was the first guy I heard say this.
100%.
He goes, there's no way they can compete with the internet. He did this whole freaking rant, and it was all true. And then he went on to say, but the sucky part about technology is they claim we all these Jetson suits and jetpacks and all this incredible stuff, but instead your cell phone craps out when you're behind a bush.
Yeah.
Right.
The problem,
this is like you ever see that movie Talladega Nights, where he says like you ain't first, you're last.
Yeah,
he's like, I was high when I said that. Same answer.
You know my problem.
There you go, man.
I feel like corporate media is no longer NBC, ABC. Now it's Google and
Alphabet. Oh, of course, that's not even a question.
Facebook.
It's, well, in a way, it's worse.
But Facebook is worse than ABC.
But it all needs to be decentralized. It needs to be decentralized.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. There needs to be decentralized, open communication where people need to find out what the fuck is really going on. We're finding that through all these corporate, all these like internet companies, whether it's Google or whether it's Facebook or Instagram, if they can just censor you based on ideology, then you don't have freedom of speech because they're the primary means that people communicate. So until we accept that there's some sort of utility, it's not as simple as it's a private company, when it's literally one of the main two or three ways that human beings share ideas across the planet fucking Earth, it's bigger than just a company. And I don't know what the solution to that is, but we have to have that conversation.
Free the software. Yeah,
right company. Now, I mean, we're not having that conversation.
They're abusing their power.
Right, because the way it censors is always in favor of the left. And the people on the left think that's a good idea. But eventually, you can't be left enough. It's just going to keep going. It's a machine. It's Pac-Man. It's just going
to
keep...
Wait. I got to ask Joe. A couple years ago, you had Jack Dorsey on your show. You got a bunch of dislikes on the video. We ended up talking. You ended up inviting me out. And I don't know.
You destroyed him.
Well, it's not about that. I wanted to ask you, like, how do you feel your opinion has changed since before we did that show and to where we're at today?
Well, there's a lot of things have opened my eyes, like, slowly but surely, like, seeing examples of people censored. And some of them that don't make any sense at all. Like, one of the best ones was Brett Weinstein and his whole... this whole Unity Party.
Yep.
When that got censored, I was like, okay. You guys banned an account for no reason because you thought that account, which is by a bunch of influential intellectuals, was going to somehow or another take votes away from what you thought was the party that should win, and so you just banned the account. So now you're making like these ideological choices about free speech. So you're saying your free speech is not as important as the result that I want, and so you're going to ban people. And when I saw that, I was like, this is wild. This is fucking wild. And then I talked to a lot of people that were the Second Amendment advocates. They were saying before the election, they were going back into their Instagrams and their Facebooks and finding posts from 8-9 years ago and banning them for those posts.
Yep.
That they were going deep. Yeah, they were doing that just specifically because they didn't want people influencing the vote in any way, 1,000 here, 100 there, like if they could just chip away through all these different angles, like
and,
this is
and make examples
and
out
let's
of
just
people.
Briefly look at that. Imagine it's one thing for an orthodoxy to take over and make you comply, but to punish you before it took over is thought crime. Before, I mean, this is mind control. This is like in science fiction, this was never dreamed of, where you're punished for behavior before the new orthodoxy comes in. So you don't just submit in the current state. You're going to pay for not adopting it before it was the new religion.
I got to correct you. This isn't not science fiction. This is what they did in the Soviet Union, where if you were on the wrong side before Stalin took over, you were executed with your family. Yeah. But so this has historical precedent.
No, I know it's been done before.
My family was literally tortured in Poland for daring to question the government or not having the proper paperwork during a random passport check.
No. I know tyrants do that, Luke. I know tyrants do that.
What is it? Listen. It's retroactive enforcement.
Yes.
Retroactive.
They cut his fucking nose in Chinatown.
Let me. I want to counter this, though, because we were actually heading in a direction in this conversation. We were talking about how we're actually starting to realize how deceptive the media is. And then I pointed it over to Drew because these same tools are what allowed, you know, Drew to be on the ground exactly. during the Rittenhouse, during the Kenosha incident, film it, and then be a witness. The media could have absolutely shut it down. You've heard it. You'd see a newspaper article and it would say white supremacist crosses state lines with gun. And that's the only thing you'd know. And they tried it. Drew, Richie, Jorge Ventura, exactly. Elijah Schaefer.
They broke that paradigm.
You guys were down there.
And then to watch the prosecutor try to go, oh, you're a right winger, you're evil. It's like, it's footage. It's raw. Like Joe said, oh, and then they saw the raw footage. Once you see that, it's game over.
He literally tried to say that my footage was slanted in a certain way. And I responded and I said, well, yes, it's BLM and Antifa literally rioting in the footage. What people need to understand is this propaganda is so dangerous, not because they're just telling lies, but they're attempting to control the narrative, which is an attempt to control your mind. And that's what's dangerous. Whether you're Republican or a Democrat, that should seriously concern you, because this is what they do to control the minds of millions of people. And it's allowed on a daily basis. And it's like, why don't it's encouraging? Why don't people take issue with this, that people are trying to control your mind on a daily basis?
Because the average man would rather be safe than be free. We're taught since kids to defer that expert at the front of the room. And it's one of the reasons they always one of the reasons they always talk about follow the experts. It's not just with COVID. It's also with this. Am I going to look at the footage and draw my own conclusion, or am I going to listen to the prosecutor?
Okay, Joe, you were saying
it's so sad because I don't know any progressive. I know a lot of progressives, and not one of them knows that one of the victims of Kyle was a pedophile. They all think it was an innocent black BLM protester.
And who raped a kid. It's not like he had attractions.
Five kids. And he was an underage boy during this, you know, battle with him. So it messed with people so badly. I know so many people that have no information about the case but have an opinion completely made up. It's
Wasn't
sad.
The other guy, didn't he get all his charges dismissed on previous
Six
cases?
Days before.
Like, yeah.
6 days before, he had a DUI charge dropped, but he was a career criminal. I mean, he went down for domestic abuse, prowling, trespassing, two DUIs, felony burglary, two counts of carrying a firearm while intoxicated.
Bro, this is
so,
cult shit.
Yeah.
Yep. We're in a cult.
Yeah.
Tell us, Joe.
Speak to us, leader.
How does the Kool-Aid taste?
Shut up, Malice.
Dr. Joe.
How's the Kool-Aid?
We are in a cult. Joe, start off.
This information is not based on reality. This is a left-wing cult. And they're pumping stuff out, and then they're confirming this belief. They're all getting together, and they're ignoring contrary evidence.
Yes.
They're ignoring any narrative that challenges their belief about what happened. And they're not looking at it realistically. They're only looking at it like you would look at it if you're in a fucking cult.
Sounds
it's
like religion.
A weird left. Cult is a religion that's just like it's just older.
Non-theistic.
You know, I had a bit about it.
Well, a cult doesn't let you ask questions. So keep Joe, go ahead.
Look, a cult is made by a guy, and that guy knows it's a cult. In a religion, that guy's dead. That's the difference. Like, religions are just cults that last longer.
You know,
some of them prove to be worthwhile. Like social and economic and even moral structures, like they actually benefit society. Like some cults, they're based on rituals or things that people learned, and they realize this is a better way to live their life. But some of them are just based on the present moment of gathering the most amount of whether it is influence or finances or what power, whatever the fuck it is. That's what this is.
Joe, and I totally agree. So let me ask the next question.
100% a left
wing. I really want to hear what you have to say. What is the period we're in now? Because it seems like it's coming to an end.
This is Kali Yuga, man. This is some weird shit that was predicted by the Bhagavad Gita. This is
good or
dumb
or wrong, battle of the gods,
yeah.
Ragnarok. Tell me.
This is what happens in cultures. Like, they go through these pitches, these ups and downs, and it's almost inevitable. Like, it's almost impossible for us with our human reward systems that are based on, like, animal emotions and biology to manage millions and millions and millions of people all on one continent with money and the economy and the fucking environment. It's almost impossible to do. So it almost always slides into authoritarianism. Right. And the best way it slides into authoritarianism is control the narrative.
Yep. Joe, you got to leave. Keep going, brother.
So you say it's almost impossible.
Happening.
How would you say we can do it?
Mushrooms.
Beautifully said.
Mushrooms!
Well, let me ask that question.
We
got to
love each other. We need mushrooms. We got to realize we're all in this thing together. We can, instead of competing with each other, just do your best and give everybody hugs.
I agree. So let's expand on that.
No,
briefly.
You don't agree. You're not in this thing with some of these
hallucinogens.
People.
Why do hallucinogens taken properly create such peace? Why are they?
Because they eliminate the ego, and the ego is responsible for most of the conflict. Most of the conflict is instead of thinking, oh, I got to get this guy back. Just relax. Everybody relax. Everybody, like, look at this. Like, what does everybody want in terms
like
of,
you
like,
forgave me 3 years ago when I was being
but
a dick.
Everybody.
And it was so much
I
better.
I tried to forgive everybody. Listen.
It was amazing.
What does everybody want in this life? You want good friends. You want to be safe. You want your children to go to good schools. You want your loved ones to be protected. You want people to get by and have a good life for as long as they possibly can. That's what everybody wants. But you think that other people are trying to stop you from having that. Other people are trying to stop you from having that. There's a few sociopaths that want to gather it all up for themselves.
There you go.
I forgive
you too,
amounts of people.
But Joe, I've had this conversation with Ian a whole lot because Ian's the voice on our show who's always telling us to stop being so dark and try and bring people together. But you look at the prosecutor in the Rittenhouse case.
He's a demon.
Overwhelmed, like lying. Yeah. You see the judge say that was a grave constitutional violation.
I think that's been going on forever.
It has.
Finally, we have the internet.
Correct. Yeah. Thank you. Yes.
And now we can see it for what it is.
And now
we can see it.
And now conservatives are realizing, you know, the old conservative line about, like, oh, if you haven't done anything wrong, don't worry about getting arrested, you'll be fine.
That's not
true. I know, but conservatives are now realizing, wait a minute, when the government, the Eye of Sauron, has you in their sights, they're going to do whatever they can.
I've been experiencing that, where, like, they just
Alex,
lie about
what
everything.
What were you just saying? About not interrupting.
Malice. Going.
I was just the one point is people
you have a lot
now,
of malice for me.
I don't have a lot of love for you.
I know,
but
start over.
I'm not going to start over. I'm just going to say my one sentence, which is conservatives now realizing when the government, which is the Eye of Sauron, has it you in their sights, they're going to do whatever they can to break you. And this is something that disproportionately hurts poor people. And the left has been arguing about that for a long time, and they were right.
That's inarguable, right?
Yes.
It was 2020.
But now the left's all anti-free speech, anti-due process.
Well, there's something to say about what's happening right now. Some people have called it the fourth turning. You could feel it. It's energetic. You know something's happening. You see the Titanic. You see the iceberg. You're like, holy cow, the ship is heading somewhere. But at the end of the day, we could still decide where it goes. And I think, to Joe's point, mushrooms, decentralization are ways to start the conversation. But I think we should focus on that as well, because I think that's the true kind of opening that we should be really examining and looking into, because there is something to talk about with so much power and influence here. We could do something incredible here.
I don't know about mushrooms, but that NAD stuff was legit.
Nicotinamide, adenine, dinucleotide.
Can we talk about DMT while Joe's here? Yes. Because he's giving me DMT next week.
I am.
Or should I not say that?
Sorry. No.
We were thinking about it.
Going down to South America for a religious retreat, perhaps?
Oh, I'm so in.
Yeah, well, I take DMT every morning.
I think we should take ayahuasca.
We all take DMT when we sleep.
That's what I was saying. Yeah, you got the joke.
Dude, we
got
to do
it. Luke's smart. You got the joke.
How do you prepare for your first time, though? Because I'm nervous.
I've heard you got to do a dieta, which is a 10-day fast, where you basically eat only...
stop all that hippie bullshit. Put your fucking woody beads aside.
But this is if you're
going to
take...
Shut your pie hole.
Only if
you don't
have to
do any of those things.
Have you taken ayahuasca?
Dive in. It's the same thing. It's dimethyltryptamine. Look, it's good to have an empty stomach. Yeah, but listen, what you really need to do is just relax and let it happen.
Have you taken Aya?
No, I've only taken DMT.
We got to do ayahuasca.
I don't know how to do shit with you.
Oh, you filthy hippie, get a haircut.
We need to. All of a sudden, I'm in his house, like, confused. When do I throw up? No, it's like all these psychedelic drugs, the big thing is just letting go. That's the biggest problem that people have.
Let yourself go, like Elvis says.
Yeah.
It's hard to just not fight it.
Well, that's one of the biggest lessons when you do delve into psychedelics is not to take yourself too seriously. Let things go. Let love and the positive energies kind of flow in a direction where you're not trying to control everything. When you're trying to control everything, that's when things get nasty and disgusting.
And
whether in relationships, whether in government, whether with religion, anytime you try to force something onto someone, shit gets bad. It gets disgusting.
I totally agree. But
nasty.
While we've got Joe here, let me just ask this one question of Joe. And I want to hear from Tim and everybody here. But this is my real question. After all the suppression of free speech we've seen in the last 20 months, and after all the attacks on medical experts that were pointing certain things out that's now all been proven right, I mean, what does the power structure do now that it's committed seppuku, suicide? I'm really concerned.
No. Don't be naive. It has not committed suicide. Most people still believe the news is accurate. Mm-hmm. Most people still believe I took horse dewormer. Most people still believe like some of the dumbest ideas, because most people are casual observers of information.
So you're saying I'm blinded by the fact that I can see what's going on.
It's your job. You're like a guy who's like a tennis analyst that thinks that everybody knows who Roger Federer is. Most people have no fucking idea, right? It's like the amount of people that actually pay attention to all this
shit.
So
I'm blinded by the fact that
I'm
informed. That's a good point.
You're very informed.
So what's
you're always on it. But
so what's
most people are uninformed because they're busy all day. They have jobs and they have kids and they have a mortgage and they fucking go bowling or whatever they like to do. They don't have the time. They watch football. They don't have time to be paying attention to all this fucking shit on.
So instead of a normalcy bias, I have kind of an awake. So what do we do then?
Listen. I was arguing with someone about the Rittenhouse trial right now. A friend of mine who's on the left who said, I don't understand how you're defending this kid. And when I said like a few key details about the case, they said, I didn't hear that. And then they responded, to be honest, I was kind of just listening in the background while I was at work.
Yeah, yeah.
It's all crazy, right? Like, should he have just showed up with an AR-15 at this protest? Like, why is he there? Like, why? He's a 17-year-old kid with a fucking
loaded gun. But then you learn his dad lived there.
Then you learn that his family had a store there, right?
Yeah.
His dad had a business.
His grandma, his cousins. He worked there. His best friend.
That was his hometown. His mom had left.
But how wild are these fucking people? This is like wild and wonderful whites of West Virginia. They said, son, load up your AR-15. You want to drive to the protest. You're 17. Like, to take a 17-year-old kid to the middle of a fucking protest with a loaded gun.
No, I agree.
It wasn't a protest. It was a riot.
It was a violent riot.
I understand. It's a riot. Okay, let's say it's a riot.
But before it happened, it was a protest.
But he shouldn't have been there, but no one should have been there.
Is anybody here besides me and Alex have children?
Negative.
When you have kids, the last thing you want to tell your 17-year-old is, hey, son, I'm going to take you down to that riot.
My son's bigger than me.
And you're going to pop off some caps.
He said, I'm going to a riot. I beat his ass before he went.
That's wild shit. Like, I'm just not a judgment call. I'm saying it's a very unusual move.
Wait, to drive
your 17-year-old kid across the state line.
I mean, I like Rittenhouse, but they're a little weird.
Wait.
But he doesn't deserve to go to prison.
The state line thing is too much.
31 miles.
Yeah, but it's
still
his,
state line, right?
I get it.
But his father lived there.
Hold on. Here's why it's much. Do you know the law? There's a law when it comes to, like, firearms, when it comes to, like, it's like state
lines. He didn't bring a gun across state lines.
Okay, but state lines are real. It's a real thing. Like, if you live in one place and you go to another place specifically for this reason, the prosecutors or the lawmakers or whoever is going to look at it very differently just because you're crossing a state line. That's just a fact.
It's like you're invading.
If you do something inside of Kansas, that's inside of Kansas.
If you decide to cross over into another place, it becomes a different thing. Right?
That being said, there are people who live in places like Buffalo and Detroit and Calexico who have enhanced IDs who are able to go back and forth as if it's
not. Is that what he had?
Well, he lived like a mile from the border.
It's a bedroom community.
And Kenosha was, it's the suburb of Kenosha.
But what a lot of people are missing is he went across the border and then got a gun.
Right.
Yeah. He didn't cross the border with the gun, correct.
So he went across the border, and then he got a gun. And also, he's not even 18. It's kind of wild. Like, if you think about an actual 17-year-old boy, they're boys.
He's more of a man than any of those police officers.
He did a very good job.
You son of a bitch with your fucking cut nose.
Hey, but at the same
Jack
time.
Jack Nicholson in Chinatown, they cut his nose.
But
talk
Joe,
too much shit.
But Joe, you got to understand, during that summer, police officers stood back. Police officers literally were told, stand down, don't do anything.
And it's not a clean issue.
That was a huge aspect to it. And it's not. And I don't think
it's
this is the best case to argue, but I think this is the kind of pivotal point that a lot of people, especially the corporate media, are focusing on, because this is the argument that they want to make to disarm people.
Well, I'll go back to they're not showing the defense arguments on a lot of TV channels. That discredits him right there. But let me ask Joe before he's got to go here. He's got to go to a comedy show tonight. Let me ask Joe his view, shifting gears, on the political correct wars.
Oh, but hold on. Keep talking about this, because this is an important thing to, like, expand on what we're talking about here. Like, this is here's the problem. Here's the big problem. Why did he have to do that?
He was called.
But hold on. Why did he have to do that?
Why did the police stand up?
No. What compelled him to do that?
Because it was anarchy.
Because there was chaos in the street, and because they were allowing it to happen.
Correct.
The reason why people were willing to tell their kid, hey, this is a good idea to get your fucking loaded gun, and we're going to, like...
It's because civilization's collapsing.
Right.
And finally go, hell, let's have a war!
This wasn't anarchy. This was state-funded, mainstream media promoted chaos.
Kamala was bailing out the
Kamala Harris was literally bailing them out with big tech social media promoting these protests.
These people aren't getting, like, detailed instructions on exactly what to do. They're Antifa people, right? They're wild motherfuckers that have criminal records.
Pedophiles.
They are getting instructions. They organize.
They're very organized.
Who's giving them organized?
Whatever the cell is.
So, Joe, what happens when he's found not guilty? I predict that.
But when they're telling him, do you think someone's telling him to attack this kid?
No, hold on.
No, it's just out of control.
They were telling him to attack that car.
Hold on, I can actually answer this.
He spent his whole life attacking kids.
There's something important. A lot of conservatives don't understand about these wealthy billionaires who fund these nonprofits. There will be two people from an organization that is funded They come down to events, and they know there's a lot of angry people who have no idea what's
going on. Antifa since handlers.
They don't say to them, hey, go attack that kid. They just say things like, if anyone tries to stop them, don't let them. Respect the diversity of tactics. It's a very common phrase. It means if someone is committing acts of violence, let them do it, and that's bad. And they have strategies. They call themselves often facilitators.
Yep.
They will come down to a riot and then guide the destruction in certain ways and try and take the violence and use it.
We got secret Antifa documents 5 years ago where they, even in Democrat areas, are working with the police and the government, and they have targets they're going to burn, things they're going to hit. It's all
not only that, but there's been
in some ways it's a rhetorical question. What I'm saying is, why did he have to do that?
Well,
he had to do that because everything was falling
apart. Right. No, but
so Joe, elaborate.
Can I just say one sentence?
Yes, sir.
I had Robert Barnes on my show this week. He worked for the defense team, and my understanding, according to Robert, is the people who ran that car dealership called Kyle and several other people because that car dealership had been hit night after night. So they were specifically called in to defend this location. There's four locations, and they circled around.
Which people
them.
Are allowed to defend their property.
Yes, of course. Especially when the police are saying we refuse to do anything.
So, Joe, go ahead, your rhetorical
people
question.
People forget how bad summer of 2020 was. Like, I lived in the middle of Hollywood when it was all at its peak, and I had to evacuate my home and hide in the woods
and stay there
for like 2 weeks until it was somewhat safe to go back.
Yeah,
like,
that's the key.
I'm surprised there wasn't more of that. There wasn't more call written.
Three dozen people died.
I mean, Joe, you left LA because of crime.
Three dozen.
Wow. Listen, I showed up on night one in Kenosha. Right? And right when I showed up on the scene, they already had dumpster trucks on fire.
Yeah.
The reason why I decided to take an Uber from Chicago all the way to Kenosha was because on Twitter, they were already taking bricks to police officers' heads and knocking them unconscious. So there was literally nothing peaceful. It was never a peaceful protest from night one.
Mostly,
I know the mainstream media doesn't
peaceful,
want to talk about
bro.
This. A mostly fiery, peaceful protest, right? But it was, listen, I always say this, Kenosha from night one was obviously a riot, but it was a crime scene for 3 days straight. And here's why I say this. On the third night when I returned back to Kenosha, I was talking to some of the people on the ground, some of the people that had their businesses burned down to the ground. When you were walking down the street, people had their windows boarded up. They were writing things like, children live here. You want to know why they were writing that? Because there was a threat to the community. There was an obvious threat to the community. People thought that
help.
They were going to die, Alex. People thought that they were going to die in Kenosha because of violent acts that were being committed by these criminals. And they're trying to paint this picture that they were peaceful protesters. At no point was Kenosha a peaceful protest on night one, night two, or night three. And Joseph Rosenbaum was violent.
At night four, after Kyle did his duty, they brought out the National Guard.
Abolish the police.
Yes, of course.
Hey, but Joe, you were saying it's all rhetorical. What's the answer then?
I don't have an answer, bro. Come on, man.
I do love the constant, like, Joe, tell us. You know, Alex is like,
I mean, he ain't going to be here the whole time. I mean, yeah.
I know, but still.
Joe, just fix the world already, all right? What are you doing? Come on, all right? We're waiting here.
Trying to guide this thing.
Do everything for us.
What was the question?
You know, Blaire's right. We forget what the fuck it was like.
It was terrifying.
It was terrifying. The world was falling apart. There was cop cars lit on fire all throughout Hollywood. They were calling a curfew in Beverly Hills at like 4 p.m. or some shit.
But you know what's
crazy
about the cop cars?
People were just smashing windows and stealing things.
Santa Monica.
And they were allowing it. They were letting it burn out.
Yep.
So people had this feeling that no one was going to protect anyone.
Correctly.
Like, it's when you look at the way things stand today, we have much more of a semblance of law and order. But when you go back to those George Floyd protests, it was anarchy. It was legitimate chaos. And I don't think people have long memories. They have very short memories.
You were talking about...
But the cop cars, actually, I know someone who rents out a ton of prop cop cars for movies in L.A., and some of those were fake, like on Melrose, which is weird. I don't
know
why.
Fake cop cars?
What? Yeah, they were prop cop cars.
Well, let me tell you, there was...
I don't know why.
There was shooting and burning and robbing in Austin and deaths. I was driving through and Andy was backing on my windows, so there was stuff going down then.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if those are fake cars, but I know that's a fun thing to say.
No,
those
cop cars weren't even real, bro.
They were made by
$3 billion of property loss.
They were prop cars, like Alec Baldwin's prop gun.
Well, the scariest thing was like looking at New York City when they were smashing windows and that really like whatever that art area is.
Soho.
Yeah, they were stealing things right out of these buildings, and the cops were literally standing on the corner watching that happen. Like, that is madness.
I remember watching that on Fox News. They were literally madness. This was I wouldn't say this was anarchy, because if we had anarchy, we would have peaceful, harmonious trade of capital.
Amen, brother.
And
Luke, come on, don't leave me hanging, Luke.
What we had is is government-funded, orchestrated chaos by the top institutions and powerhouses in this world saying, I want this to happen. I will incentivize it. I will spread propaganda. I will put fuel on the fire, guaranteeing that this violence explodes.
Wait, can I ask you? They wanted people to riot?
100%.
100%.
100%.
So I got a question for you. I know I'm not trying to change subjects because the Rittenhouse thing is huge and anarchy is all... What about Joe Biden? Because you early on said he's senile a year before he got in.
Everybody said it. It wasn't anything.
Well, let me ask you then. That's my next question. Everybody, go around the round table. What is the prediction? Because now they're in the Washington Post, New York Times, saying Joe Biden's got to go. Kamala Harris, Pete Buttigieg. What happens to Joe Biden?
Well, have you heard the things that like they're trying to figure out whether like is it Jill Biden was asking whether? Did you read those things?
Yeah.
Jill Biden was asking whether or not they can get rid of Kamala.
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
I don't.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if it's true. I just read.
No. That was even. That was. I was watching. It was like on MSNBC when before I came on the show.
If you
but choose at the end of the day, if the end of the day, like they've got to find someone who could fill Joe Biden's shoes. But if they decided to have Pete Buttigieg leapfrog over Kamala Harris, it's going to be wild. Because even like the hardcore lefties are going to abandon each other. Well, like it's going to get really wild because the people that wanted her in there because of identity politics and now have a point of argument, even whether or not they think she was good or not. They think that she got in, they wanted her in for whatever specific reasons, and now she's in, and you're going to have this guy leapfrog over her. If that happens, if they think the only way they can win in 2024 is Pete Buttigieg, we're going to have wild.
And see, I am kissing Joe's ass because he's really politically smart. I knew this 20 years ago, but he's doing it now. Exactly. They're clearly prepositioning Buttigieg to take over. It's all over the freaking news.
Or maybe he's the vice president.
It's a trial balloon. Because her approval ratings are 28%.
Right.
Everyone in Washington hates her. Gavin Newsom hates her because she took the California position for the presidency away from him.
What? So he hates her?
Of course he hates her.
How do you know?
Because she's... talking
shit?
I'm not.
Is that why they cut your nose?
No.
Motherfucker.
That's fake. It's
Chinatown.
A false flag. You didn't get
Chinatown.
Careful, Alex. You don't want to get in trouble with that.
His nose.
I think they're going to take Michelle Obama or Oprah.
2024. No way.
Okay, well, they're openly saying everywhere we've got to replace Biden now, and that's everywhere. So I'm asking, what are they planning? How
bro,
they
that
do
Satchel Paige thing was over the top. People were like, check, please.
What was that?
This the Negro thing. The Negro leagues and the.
He goes, he's the number one. I won't even say it. He's the best in the world.
Yeah.
Did you see though when the judge and I keep going back to Rittenhouse case. The judge said, I hope the Asian food's not on the Long Beach port.
Yes.
And they were like, what a racist.
Horrible.
And then Joe Biden comes out and said,
took the heat off him.
Let's be 100% clean here.
Right.
On this whole thing. The point is he's degenerating and falling apart.
Clearly
fast.
Something's wrong.
So
and
he can't wait much longer.
It's not fair. It's not. It's like to judge him, like in comparison to like judging Obama when he was in office or judging even Trump when he was on. It's not fair. He's got a problem. There's something wrong with him. Right, it's not as simple as I don't like the things he stands for or the special interest groups that have got him into power. I don't like his politics. That's not what's going on here. This is a man who's compromised. Something's wrong, and he's deteriorating. And either we admit that, and we all know it, or we don't admit it. So if we don't admit it, then China just starts fucking filling up Facebook with a bunch of fake pages,
and
we have chaos constantly. You know, I mean, that's part of what's going on, like with the conversations that people are having online.
Yeah, nobody respects us because of him.
Right.
And it's insane.
He's the first president who's literally shitty.
Bye!
Oh. Yeah, poopy pants.
Michael Malice, ladies and gentlemen. Give it up for Michael Malice.
I think
but that's what's part of what's happening. You know, it's like we're in the cult. And if you're in the cult, you have to pretend that the cult leader's okay. You know the cult leader's not okay.
In fact, have you
so
seen all the Twitter stuff?
More and more people are opening their mouths. More and more people are going, hey, we gotta do something. And people are like, yeah, okay. And so they're coming out of this fucking fog, and they're going, what about that Pete Buttigieg guy? Well,
who's
he took 3 months
B?
Off for his fucking kid. Like, that's okay. People have short memories. Let's get him back in here.
Well, what about the meme I sent you today of, like, the Hollywood guys going, he's a rock star. He's punk rock. I mean, there's still some are still trying
to... Oh, that's Joe Biden. Yeah, Joe Biden.
Well, Pete Buttigieg does have intelligence agency connections. So he was tried to be as the kind of prop guy. They did try to push him. So I wouldn't be surprised if they try to push him again.
Of course.
But again, the mainstream media, let's admit this. The mainstream
don't call
media,
mainstream, Luke.
Corporate media put in Biden. The corporate media will be putting in the next president of the United States.
And
to me, Biden is the fall guy.
They're definitely going to try. But the problem is they don't have like a clear, like a person that stands like, like on the right, if Trump wasn't around, you look at Ron DeSantis and go, that's the guy.
Yeah.
He's strong.
Or Pence.
He's reasonable.
Yep.
Shut the fuck. He's strong.
No?
He's reasonable. He's calm. He's made great judgment choices during this pandemic with Florida. They've turned out to be, like, although controversial, ultimately you go good to like the end result. Good choices.
Well, you know why I don't like Trump.
In terms of like business, in terms of like real estate, all these different things that didn't deteriorate like they did in these other countries where they kept the same mortality rate. You look at Florida's business did very well in comparison to like California. Where California took a big hit. The restaurants, and even though they have the same sort of mortality rate, when you adjust for age, Florida did better. And then when you look at business, Florida did way better.
California has doubled the cases of Florida right now.
But here's the next question.
But whose fault is that? That's
wrong. I didn't get, like, money because I supported Trump. I didn't think Trump was perfect. I thought that he was
You got Pokemon dollars, right?
Exactly. I thought he was more of a populist, better than, you know, what we were being offered. And so, with Hillary Clinton, who I know is evil. But now, I almost see Trump as destructive because he becomes the opposition to the Democrats, but he's got his own issues. I want to be populist. Not left or not right, but Americans coming together and saying no to Joe Biden, no to the Democratic Party that lied about Russiagate and all of it. I don't think Trump's a bad guy, but I want to be clear. At the end of the day, he went along with warp speed. Mm. He went along with the experimental shot, and he's pig-headed, and he won't admit he was wrong. So I'm not going to criticize Biden and Pfizer for this and Fauci and then give Trump a pass. And with Trump's base, I go to these big events with 5, 10, 20,000 people. They're really upset, and then Trump is so pig-headed that he is still going along with the vaccine.
They booted him. They booted him in Alabama. He got booted.
We have to say, always talk to your doctor about what's right for you. Don't take advice from people on the internet. Talk to your doctor if you're feeling unwell and you want to get advice on what you should do to treat yourself.
Pfizer loves you.
Take
your booster shot.
Fauci
is good.
Now they're doing a...
This show's outrageous.
New York has announced booster shots.
I'm not comfortable here.
The UK now... It's now
fucking trailer on the side of the road.
Shit about welcome
that.
To
don't
the
you know who I am?
Wait, Jake. I was like, hey, joking. Why are you? We're in a trailer on the side of the road.
England is announcing... If you don't have the boosters, you're going to be locked in your house just like Austria and Australia.
And France too.
But let's not talk about it because they'll ban us on there. You're right. I want hundreds of shots... And I think Trump's wonderful then. Alex Jones is saying, I'm sick of Trump.
Why haven't you guys gotten him drunk yet?
We can't do that. That's bad.
You haven't even thought
But listen.
This
RV's
going to crash.
There's a big difference between someone's private medical decisions. The way I see it is I went to the doctor, you went to the doctor, and they gave us specific medical advice. Joe, let me tell you. When I talked to the doctor, I actually asked them. I said, I don't want ivermectin or Z-Pak. I said, the monoclonal antibodies fixed me up just right good. And the doctor said, no, I want you to finish what you've been prescribed. And I said, do I really have to? And they said, yes, because if it comes back, this is what we're prescribing you. And so I was actually like kind of critical. And the media still lies about it. The point is, if you go to your doctor and you figure out whatever you want, I don't care. That's fine. Do what you want to do. If you know, a lot of people have asked me, like, would you get the vaccine now? Well, I got Regeneron, the monoclonal, so I can't. And it provides 8 months of protection or whatever. That's what they're saying. The point is, mandating by government a medical procedure for you to buy lunch is fucking insane.
It is.
We're already swearing on the show.
It's over.
But if someone, we've had so many people on the show who are like, one guy was in his 50s and he says doctor recommended it. He got it. He's absolutely fine. He feels great. If you choose to do it, I don't care what you choose to do. I'm not going to pretend to be a doctor. I'm not going to pretend to know the secrets of the universe. But I will stand up and say, fuck the government. If they're going to tell you, hey, you're obligated to get a permanent medical procedure. Otherwise, you can't work. You can't eat food. You can't go to the movie.
Well, Tim, let's fact check this. Fauci and Gates came out last week in videos I've played like 50 times. People can pull this up. And they both said, oh, sorry. It really doesn't work or do anything. We've got a new vaccine coming out. After 6 months, there's basically no immunity from the shot. That's not a vaccine.
That's paraphrasing.
It's a paraphrasing.
Yeah, come on. Like the challenge with this stuff is...
No. Joe, tell him.
It wanes. It wanes after time.
The
real problem is it's unscientific because they don't recognize the natural immunity from previous infection. Like if you have a real infection with COVID and you recover, you have a more robust natural immunity. It's been shown by that Israeli study, which was 2.5 million people that had between 6 and 13 times better immunity than you got from the vaccine.
Let Joe finish.
They're in denial about this. So they negate this and they pretend that it's difficult to measure, but it's not difficult at all. We do it at my studio all the time. Yep. You do a very simple test for antibodies. You can see it very clearly. if it's a, you know, it's you do this test, you get a drop of blood, and you see your immunity. You find out that you have antibodies. It's not hard. If that's the case, that's just as good, not just as good. Let's be kind and say it's as good, but
well,
it's
let me
not.
Add this. No, far better.
It's far better than you get if you got infected.
He got infected.
He got COVID. He recovered. So he has 6 to 13 times better immunity than someone who gets the vaccine, has like 2 weeks recovery from the vaccine, and now can go out into the world. He's got better coverage.
I'll say two things. The first is that I think politically this is a pit trap. Because a trick. It's you walk and then you stumble through the leaves and you fall into the spikes. Because right now they're saying we are going to mandate 3 shots in the UK, Austria, France. And then what happens is you end up with Rand Paul, who I like the guy, but he says, why aren't we taking natural immunity into the case? And I said, why are you in any way excusing mandates for medical procedures, whether it be a test or a shot? Mm-hmm. If we're talking about natural immunity, we're talking about you going to a facility, taking time out of your day to get a medical test done if you want to buy food.
No. He's taking one step. He's taking one step in this examination of this narrative.
In their direction, though.
No.
He's saying
one step in the navigation of this narrative is to look at what you're ignoring.
Yeah, so why aren't you allowed to talk about natural immunity?
You're ignoring natural immunity. Well, I know your whole case is bullshit. So everything you say, whether you're in for mandates, whether you're telling children they have to get it, whatever the fuck you're saying, as soon as you say your natural immunity from previous infection doesn't count, or you try to pretend that it's impossible to check when you can check in seconds. If you vaccinate someone, they're not good for 2 weeks. You can check their immunity in seconds. I have a fucking video of my phone of me doing it.
Let me just say this. The FDA put a letter out last week under a 4-year lawsuit, and they said no one that we've looked at over millions who had natural immunity has ever transmitted the virus, but everyone that takes the vaccine can at the same level.
Yeah, I don't buy that. Yeah, I think people just haven't reported whether or not they transmitted the virus. And it's not as simple. It's like you have to, like, somehow or another, they have to, like, quantify that you had the virus and then gave it to somebody else.
I'm just going off different things.
Yeah.
Someone who gets this is exactly what they say. If you get the vaccine, I think it's an order of magnitude less likely to get sick, and it's less severe. If you do get sick, you're equally likely to transfer the virus to someone else.
But Fauci just came out and said that's not true anymore. I have the freaking clip.
Right. After a while, you're still going to get sick. I've had 3 friends now be hospitalized that were vaccinated.
Well, so we had...
Hospitalized with COVID.
Wait, Tim, the elephant in the room, look at the border, okay? Why is it, if the federal government is so concerned with COVID spreading in the United States of America, why is it that Americans have to go on lockdown? Why is it that Americans have to receive these mandatory jab mandates? But there are millions of people, since Biden has taken office, that have flooded over the United States southern border. Not a single vaccine mandate has been issued to these people that are not even Americans. And you want to know what's pissing Americans off right now, whether left or right, is that there are people that are coming from different countries freely over the southern border without any jab mandates, right. But Americans are losing their lives. First responders, medical examiners, people that are professionals, people that have dedicated their lives, that are experts, that are now being put out on the street. They're Americans, and that's what's bothering people right now.
The document just came out. I gotta say this.
I don't want to.
The document just came out. The Minnesota governor said inflate COVID numbers to keep shutdown going.
This is what really, really annoys me about all this. Drew just made a massive political point.
I was making.
And everybody keeps going back into the argument about we should all sit under the mandates but discuss the science, when no one here knows what the fuck they're talking about. What I do know is that 1 million+ people did cross the border with not a single mandate, but they are firing nurses. And then people argue natural immunity, and they argue big. And I'm like, I don't care about any of that. You are not going to mandate a public policy on the people and then ban people.
I agree. Drew, go ahead. The governor.
No, this is the point.
For sure, it's a power move.
Yeah. But why is it
100%
power move?
The governor
said, I want a lockdown for power. He admits it's all a fraud.
This is why I am so hell-bent on talk to your doctor. We're not going to discuss.
Yeah, why is the Minnesota governor telling
people to stop doing that, dude. You are driving us back into an argument that takes us away from the fact that they are mandating a medical procedure. I don't care if it's an X-ray. I don't care if it's a physical. I don't care if they want to feel my toes. We shouldn't be sitting here going like, well, this scientist said this and they were talking about numbers. No, 1 million people crossed the southern border with no mandate. firefighters, police, nurses fired from their jobs. And all anyone keeps doing is keep saying, let's have a conversation about efficacy.
No, I agree, you're
efficacy
right.
is irrelevant. You talk to your doctor, you figure out what makes sense for you, and I'll tell you this.
I don't think
your mandates are meaningless.
Yeah, it's two different arguments. Yeah. I agree with your argument.
Nobody disagrees
I'm
with you.
I'm saying the governor
most
of
people don't know. Most people don't
exactly.
know about the people.
Joe's right. No, most people don't know.
Let's talk more about that.
Well, Joe's right.
The Minnesota governor admits the lockdown was for political control. He got caught in emails. Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, but how many people know that people are literally exactly. not just being allowed across the border, but actually like allowed to enter into the country?
Yeah. Yeah, we got to do that to fly on airplanes. We got to have tests.
But if if you're coming even legally, if you're coming legally, you have to have the COVID vaccine now. And again, we understand this was never about your health. This was always about your subjugation. You look at what happened where they mandate this medical procedure, where they have the most strictest vaccine passports in England, in Israel, in Singapore. You see the highest rises in cases. Gibraltar, one of the most vaccinated places in the world per capita. Just canceled Christmas because they had a surge in COVID cases.
Vermont has the highest cases in America, and it's the highest vax.
Exactly.
It's all Bernie Sanders' fault. That's what I heard.
Yeah. It is.
No, you know what? They want to control. We've talked about this, Alex, right? They want a controllable class. They want a two-tier system. They want the elites at the top, and they want the people at the bottom that they could control that are not going to say anything, that are not going to protest, that are not going to fuss about it, because they want people, millions of people, they want people in this country that are illiterate to the United States Constitution, so that they don't protest or fuss about it. It's not left or right, Democrat or Republican. They just want people that they could control. And what's happening at the southern border is literally proving that right now as I speak. It's not stopping. It's not stopping. This is why I tell people, it doesn't matter. It's not left or right. It's not Republican or Democrat.
This is why you can't have this many people on a fucking podcast. Everybody just starts yelling.
Okay, let me correct what Sean Hannity just had to say.
Everybody's saving lives.
The Americans don't care about the Constitution. This is just boomer bullcrap that people spout on Fox News.
So you think the United States Constitution is boomer bullcrap? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, I do. I'm saying
wow.
Russia. Yeah, I'm saying
Russia.
Interesting.
100%.
Russian asset.
If you looked at what happened, with the lockdowns, they did not have to use a lot of force. The overwhelming majority of people were more than happy to have their freedoms taken away for the illusion of safety. The average man does not want to be free. He merely wants to be safe. And the Constitution.
His name is Keith Olbermann. And you can say it by name.
And the, no one's going to know that. Joe, no one's going to know that reference. And the Constitution has been a dead letter from the George Washington administration. They were locking people up for criticizing the government in the 1790s. It's a complete joke.
ResetWars.com.
And they didn't know any better. They didn't have
There are minefields before us where they pull you in their direction. I've talked about how the conservatives, there's no real opposition to the left other than, like, the Democrats will come out and say, we want to ban assault rifles. And the Republicans will say, no. But where is the Republican leadership? This is actually something you told me. Where is the Republican leadership to come out and say, we want to abolish gun laws? Everything is always the establishment pulling us in this direction, and the right is just saying, slow down.
What's
there.
What's the quote?
Slow
say the
there.
Quote.
What quote?
Conservatism is progressivism driving the speed limit.
Oh, there you go.
Yes.
So this is why, you know, we had a conversation a while ago about science and Pfizer and all these pills and stuff. And I was like, yo, are we actually just arguing the degree to which we are going to live under the mandate?
I agree, but what about the exodus of the people from mainstream media? Joe, everything's collapsing. Your show is the epicenter of everybody leaving the establishment and going to independent. How does dinosaur media finally die? Because if Joe Rogan's the meteorite that hit the planet and kills the dinosaurs.
It doesn't have to die. AM radio is still around, too.
Well, let's
keep it alive. Keep it alive barely.
Alex,
that's
what you want.
You don't want your enemy to die. You want you to keep your foot on its chest.
So it's like a little zombie.
It's gonna lose its efficacy when CNN and Fox and MSNBC are looked at exactly like you look at Marlboro or Lucky Strikes. Mm. When the average American regards a corporate journalist exactly as they regard tobacco executive. You know they're selling you a product. You know that product's deadly. Let them sell it.
Yeah, but
people want to buy it, but that's all it is.
Lucky Strikes gives you a nice head rush.
Well, so does watching these shows because you hate the liberals, you hate the conservatives. You
get to go to Lucky Strikes,
get to go to Flavor Country for a little bit.
Now, how much support?
No, like filterless camel.
We should ask ourselves, how much support does the corporate media have, and how much of it is an illusion?
They don't anymore.
Yes.
Did you see in the ratings?
They pretend.
The average CNN show has 100,000 viewers.
if they're
Isn't
lucky,
that crazy?
Right?
Yeah, but we know
how
that.
How many of them are actually like into it, right? How many of them just flipping through the channels?
If That's Joe Rogan difference. Farts, it gets 5 million views.
But if you're flipping through the channels, are you really into it? Is it something you're looking forward to? I mean, how many people are actually looking forward to?
No,
watching
you're like,
any
look at
those?
Brian Stelter. He's a sack of filth.
Oh,
he's a fake
what
fraud.
What the fuck are you saying?
Like, they seek the personalities.
All right, I love him. I actually have a sexual desire for Brian.
I'm still on this. I think the corporate media is now Alphabet, Google, Facebook, Meta. How do we face this in the next 20 years?
If they're smart, what they would do is go back to straight news. Straight, objective. Just have all the ads
you want. A plane crash.
Have all the ads you want, but have objective, completely unbiased news. If they did that, I think it would turn it around. If we knew that everyone that was reading all the news, like if we get to a point through all these independent social media applications and the distribution of information, when we know what they're saying is verified, we know it's true. So they have to tell the truth. If they just told the truth and give you a synopsis of what's happening in the world, they would actually make more money.
What concerns
and they would
me
have
is
less polarization.
Deep fakes
and they
concern
would,
me.
Right, but
that's not possible.
That's a real
Joe.
Problem. That's a real problem.
It's not deep possible because at the very least, they're going to have a bias in terms of what they cover, what they don't.
Maybe. Or maybe they just get together with a panel that decides like what is the most important in terms of national security, the economy, all the different things about climate. What are the issues that are really, that we know are real, that we can cover in an unbiased way? If someone came along and did that, I guarantee you, you would get enough of people from both sides. Once it's been clearly established that it's actually unbiased news, I think they would be massively commercially successful.
But
and
look,
that
look at,
is
look at,
the irony.
And they do it by
wait,
showing
wait,
both
on,
sides.
On.
Like, here
Alex,
with this person, that
let's
person.
Let's take a look at Breaking Points with Crystal and Sagar.
Sagar. Perfect
sorry.
Example.
But no, they're getting smeared as alt-right and far-right now.
By who? Bunch of pussies. Who wants to
listen? Yeah, Tim, why are you worried about
them? No, stop, stop, stop.
But their audience keeps
I'm
growing.
Not talking
that's,
over.
That's true, but
their
if,
audience
you're, if
is huge.
There's an issue with this idea of the left populists and the right populists can come challenge the elites. Crystal and Sagar were...
Sagar, you
Sagar.
Son of a bitch. He's my friend,
sorry.
Piece of shit.
Say his name one more time.
Sagar!
Sagar.
Sagar! Sagar!
Braveheart.
So we did a segment on the show. Young Turks said that, you know, Joe Rogan's basically Alex Jones or Tucker Carlson at this point.
That's hilarious.
And people responded saying, so is Crystal and Sagar. Well, when they
why
left,
are we listening to Sink Turd?
It's not about... Why are we? It's about why does he have millions of subscribers and get 30 million views?
He was force-fed everybody.
Why are you distracting me when I have to leave? You keep going down these dark alleys.
Oh, dude,
there's
it's
no
just
answers.
Getting dark.
ResetWars.com.
What do you mean? Like a place you can't...
I want to talk about Klaus Schwab. Can we go?
Hey,
Joe's
got to go.
Let me make a point.
Let's get a final statement from the great Joe Rogan.
What's
the
point? I love the idea that we can bring everyone together, but some people are just diametrically opposed to what we believe in.
But it's obvious. After a while, you watch that guy talk, and you're like,
all right, let me get a question into Joe before he's got to go.
These are silly people.
Let me get a question.
But hold on. There's so many fucking silly people. You know, like, you don't have to take into consideration their statements about every fucking thing that happens with every person. You realize they're silly. You know they're silly. That's why you brought them up. Ignore them.
No. I didn't bring him up because he's silly. I brought him up because he gets tens of millions
no,
of views.
No, he doesn't.
Yes, he does. He
does. Does not. If you look at all the views, but how many individual unique people are there? It's not tens of millions.
No. I'm not talking about unique. I'm just
right,
saying.
But it's the same fucking people. It's like if tens of millions of people. They put out a lot of content. They have 100,000.
Okay, Joe's got to go. Can I ask one question?
But it doesn't matter.
Joe,
you agree with them or disagree with them. You don't. If you don't agree with them, you don't have to keep bringing them up over and over and over again. Just fucking ignore them.
They're only
Joe,
as relevant just, as we make them.
Yeah.
Ask just one question. Disagree. Because I've been big in the media for 20-something years. You've been
huge
forever.
That's why they cut your nose.
Listen, but this is a real question.
Son of a
so
bitch.
I know you don't want to sound rock
snitch.
Star or arrogant. About, yeah, fuck him. He's a horrible person.
Yeah, fuck you.
It's fake.
I'm right here, Charles.
You.
Bring it. Come on.
Don't hurt me.
Nicholson.
I'm a gorilla.
Chinatown.
Ask, cut your fucking nose.
Joe, let me ask this question.
Okay, Boomer. We all saw your meme.
Boomer.
Hey, Joe.
Whoa,
I love
whoa,
it.
Whoa.
I'm generation
next.
He's giving you attention here. Joe, seriously, answer the question. What is it like to not just be probably the most famous person other than like a president right now in the world, but to have done it independently on your own? That's a major sea change. I celebrate that. I'm blessed to know you. You're a great guy. What is it like to be at the epicenter of the zeitgeist?
I don't think about that. If I thought about that, I'd be fucked.
Well, it's a real question. Tell me.
I don't know. That's my answer. Black helicopters.
Okay, but you have. But it seems like as you've gotten, right in the middle of the zeitgeist, you've gotten more politically involved. Not because you wanted to, but you feel like you needed to. Because you're
well,
a good guy.
This it's not that I got in the middle of the zeitgeist. This pandemic exposed the fragility of our society. That so many people are willing to give up their freedom for this like bizarre fake security that doesn't exist. Like you're talking about the most unsecure thing ever, a pandemic virus that's going through people and then a solution, a medical solution that doesn't entirely work. And everybody's like forcing you to get involved and take this and ignore all risks because they did and they want you to be on their side. It's madness. And as soon as you see that kind of madness, if you don't say something, then you fall into tyranny. And that's what the fuck is happening. And whether or not people realize what they're doing, most of the people that are doing it are cowards. Because if you stand up and you say, hey, I don't think you should vaccinate children, people are, they start freaking out. Like fucking Donald Sutherland in fucking Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
They attack McConaughey.
That's what it is. It's like everybody's scared. Like you can't even have the conversation.
Like Tim Pool and you cuss.
But here's the thing about you, and here's the thing about me. When someone is unvaccinated and they survives COVID pretty fucking quick, they go, "Wait a minute, I didn't know that was available." Right. And you go, "Well, how do you know?" When I made a video like 3 days after I had COVID, I'm like, "I feel pretty good." Like lies. And then 2 days later, I put up this fucking this test.
It's like Tim said, they were mad he survived.
Yeah, they're mad I survived too. But you know, it's because they took the chance and they got vaccinated and they feel like you should have done that too because they realize there's a certain amount of risk involved and they got through it. They're like, you fucking do it. It's like I jumped into the water from the cliff. You jump. Jump, pitch. I jumped.
What about Aaron Rodgers, who I know you helped out as well? Yeah. It's him. I mean, they're demonizing him, calling him a white supremist on ESPN. I'm flipping through the channels.
Did they say that on ESPN?
I swear to God. I'm flipping through.
It
was a sports show and I'm flipping through cable. What's his name?
They call him right wing.
Where's Skip Bayless? Yep. Where's Skip Bayless?
Yeah. He's that right other football wing guy.
Skip Bayless is totally on with a big black guy. And all I know is they go, he's a white nationalist.
Oh, that guy's not a white nationalist. But this is like people say things to get a lot of attention. And they say things as maybe they even mean it. Here's the thing with Aaron Rodgers. That guy, in any other time in history, if a friend calls you up and goes, hey, man, you had the flu. What did you do? I say, oh, I took a Z-Pack, I took a this, I took a that, I was better in a couple of days. I got a vitamin infusion, that's really big, that helped me a lot. And they go, okay, I'm going to try that. And they do it, they get better, and they go, thanks. Everybody's happy. Like, oh, I would like to do what Aaron Rodgers did if I get sick, because he was better pretty quick. Oh, Joe Rogan did that. Oh, I should do what they did, because I'll get better pretty quick. I'm not saying don't get vaccinated. I'm saying if you do get sick, this is what I did, and this is how I got better. Mm-hmm. All the decisions you make outside of that are on your own. I'm just telling you what I did.
You mean Pfizer lets us hear from you instead of them?
It doesn't have anything to do with Pfizer. It's just human beings. The influence that Pfizer has is minimal in comparison to the influence we have on each other.
No, I agree.
That's what the real problem is when people do things and they make a choice, they want everybody else.
But you got better in 2 days. Tim got better in a couple days.
It worked, right?
I took Joe. I was taking
really
ivermectin,
bad.
And
I know
got
you.
Sick.
I was. Really I know you were really
I think
bad.
I was
but
well, like, Ian was also really bad.
Dude, it worked
and,
like, within an
but
hour.
But the reason I called is because I was like, I talked to a doctor. They said, look, it's a virus. Sleep it
but
off.
But here's the thing: it's monoclonal antibodies are the big thing.
Not just
I
that.
Took when I said that I took ivermectin. I said I took it in a laundry list of other things that I took. And I didn't say that first. I said monoclonal antibodies. I said Z-Pack. I said ivermectin. I said all these things, but all they focused on was ivermectin.
But Joe,
antibodies are super effective. It's been proven so.
And they're authorized for emergency
use. Yes. It's a totally authorized.
And the company's been around since 1988. They're not like giving liability protection. That's why I trust them.
Oh, look at
that. But Alex, I also took ivermectin when
Joe's
I was in the
house. Joe's got to go. Let me ask you one question, Joe.
Okay.
One question. No one knows. You got better in 2 days. You got better in three. I got better in like a day with this stuff. Aaron Rodgers, how fast did he get better? He's somebody who's never even sick.
He's playing soon.
He played. He just won on Sunday. He played.
So he never even got sick with the protocol.
No, he was sick before that. He wasn't feeling good. He asked me what I did. I told him. I connected him with some people, and he had his doctor got him all the proper medications that he needed, and monoclonal antibodies and all the other stuff, and he got better fairly quickly afterwards. But also, He's a fucking super athlete. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, yeah. We're not talking about like your 85-year-old grandmother.
Yeah, yeah.
We're talking about a legit NFL quarterback, fucking super athlete. So comparing him to the average normal Joe walking on the street is crazy. He's literally the elite of the elite in terms of professional
athletes.
Joe
Rogan, I love you. And
I love you too, bitch.
Joe's got a show. So he's bouncing out.
Love you, buddy. It's a job.
You too.
Thanks for coming by.
Thank you.
See you tomorrow, dude.
I'm gonna go take a piss on me back.
Tell the truth.
Hey, and Joe, keep in mind.
Bye, Joe. Nice.
Got a big guest tomorrow.
Joe, tomorrow the verdict might come in.
Oh, it's chaos.
It's gonna be chaos.
Chaos.
Oh, yeah, I'll be here.
Rats in the streets.
Yeah. I know. Yeah, it's gonna be crazy. That's why we told Drew to stick around. We were like, Drew, you got to stick around.
Constitution.
If now everyone's hugging.
Did you say he was
pictures.
Taking selfies while Joe
Lydia,
was talking?
Lydia, you're supposed to be switching. You're supposed to be switching
no
the
switching.
Screen.
Do your
what
job,
you
woman.
Now, Blaire, now's your chance. Talk.
Yeah, talk about some more.
I felt like I was just high
about,
or something.
Talk about
I
some
couldn't
more,
even believe
talk
that.
About some more felonies, Blaire.
Oh, my God. Back in the room. I just went into a legit vortex. That was crazy.
You're good. Perfect.
Oh, man. So right now, for those that are watching, a good portion of the crew, everyone's saying goodbye. They're peacing out. Joe actually has a show. He's playing it. And that's why, you know, when everyone was like, hey, if we're going to have all these people, get Joe. And he's got a show. He's not going to be. But Joe was like, dude, I'm going to do it. And he was here. I was like, he's not taking it from anybody. He's telling everybody to shut up.
He's a team player. He let everyone know what they needed to know. And the show's not over, guys. Alex is coming back. Drew
Alex
just
is
sat
coming
down.
Back. I thought they were
Alex
both
is
no,
coming
back.
I'm sorry, Blaire. I'm sorry you have to. you're going to guess. Gonna be sit- Ian's going to come on in. So the show, again, this is the part two of the show. And I think we're going to go for another hour.
Can
probably
we get,
oh, yeah, more.
Can
I mean,
we get me another bandage?
Hours.
I want to see if I'm still bleeding.
Yeah, I'll grab you something.
Yeah.
Can someone grab me? I need a water.
As Alex
said,
you were
the virtual
sacrifice
as well.
Today, Malice.
Water.
Somebody get Tim Pool water.
Alex is coming back, and basically only Joe has to peace out because he's got his show to do. And
this is when we start talking about psilocybin.
So, well,
who likes psilocybin? Raise your hand.
I'm
like, kinda, I said suicide.
No. I like. Thank you, sir. I like talking about the things that Michael talks about. You know, like police, constitution, freedom, liberty. That's my jam. And I don't know if you saw that rant I did where they got really mad at me.
Of course, I saw it. I was my porn. My sheets are ruined.
It's
his
pre-workout.
People were saying it was because you were dewormed that it changed you.
I know it's funny, but like that's not the first rant I've ever had. There's a video from our old studio where I'm like, they went to this dude's house in Wisconsin and were protesting in front of his house. They had set these same protesters set fire to a house before. And when the guy brandished a shotgun, the police came and arrested him from his own house.
Yep.
And I was like, these people will come to your home. They will protest you. These activists, obviously. Yeah. And the police will kick in your door and they will bash your teeth in. And then they're like, Tim Pool's an inch. But the reason the left got mad was a reaction to the right. The right was like, look at this epic rant from Tim Pool. Yeah. He's like saying that the law, federal law enforcement went for James O'Keefe. I was surprised. You know what's really funny about this is when that with that rant, the left came out angry at me. And I'm like, I was literally saying, I literally abolish the police. Ooh. I was like, abolish the police. Like the feds kicked in James O'Keefe's doors as federal law enforcement. They leaked his privileged legal communications. This is a violation of every core tenet this country is supposed to believe in. Right. Your privileged access to legal assistance. And then the left was like, haha, he's bad. That's fascism. And I'm like, I thought I was agreeing with you.
I want to ask Drew a question, Mr. Constitution. Given what you saw in Kenosha, what is your perspective on the police?
My perspective is that the police are going to have to start making some serious decisions soon, because if they're not going to side with their constitutional oaths, they are literally betraying the American people. So I think when police are getting into that type of territory, they're going to start enforcing a police state.
Yeah.
So I think right now where we are with the advent of Marxism, cultural Marxism becoming mainstream, I think the excuse when police come out and say, I'm just doing my job, is what the Nazis said. Mm. So I think right now that is a crime against humanity. And I think when police aren't having the will to say, you know what, I'm not going to enforce this, I'm going to continue to do my job, I think they're going to have to make that decision. But if they do that, if they decide not to and pull out of it, I think that that's something they need to consider before they become police officers. Yeah. Because if you're going to take a job like that, you're going to have to be prepared to make a decision whether I'm going to obey unconstitutional or illegal edicts or mandates, or I am going to resign.
Just another I just got one quick question. Given that all gun laws are unconstitutional, violate the Second Amendment, what do you think of police officers that arrest people who have guns that might be in violation of the Second Amendment, who are otherwise peaceful people?
Repeat it one more time.
police who enforce gun laws, which are all unconstitutional against peaceful citizens. What do you think of those police?
And speak more into the mic. Your audio's low.
Is my audio low?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I just think that police, I think the biggest issue right now with police officers, and I've talked to many of them, I've had conversations with them, I think a lot of them are really like illiterate to the law itself. Not all of them, but every time you talk to one of them, like they're really not sure how they're enforcing the law correctly. Like they're not even aware of some of the laws themselves.
You're just completely ignoring my question.
Yeah.
Gun laws are all unconstitutional. What do you think of police officers who enforce gun laws against peaceful citizens?
I think the Second Amendment is for all Americans.
Right. So what do you think, again, for the third time, what do you think of police officers who enforce gun laws against peaceful citizens?
I think that's just something they're going to have to decide to do, whether they're going to do it or not.
Well, what do you think of them?
That's what I think.
That they're just going to have to you're just going to shrug your shoulders?
So they're if just a cop have arrests, to make a decision.
So if a cop arrests someone who has a handgun illegally, who's not hurting anybody, or has some kind of red flag thing, what do you think of that police officer who puts that person in jail?
Yeah, I don't think that's a good thing.
But what do you think of that individual?
The individual?
The individual police officer, yeah.
That's what I just said, yeah.
They're evil.
Are they? Yeah, but you said that's not a good thing. You know, me burning a cake is not a good thing as well.
Yeah,
like,
I think
it's
not a good
thing. Human being, his name is Officer
You're
John.
The same question over and over.
Officer
again.
John
well, you're
Smith.
Not answering it.
Let me phrase a question. There was a woman, I tell the story all the time, mm-hmm. who was from Pennsylvania with a legal gun and drove into New Jersey.
Right.
And we'll give the cop a name. Officer John Smith pulled mm-hmm. her over. And he said, you know, your taillight's out or whatever. And he said, do you have a weapon on you? He said, yes, I do. And he says, oh, okay. She politely informed him, but in New Jersey, you can't have it. So he took her out, he cuffed her, and they tried putting her in prison for 4 years. How do you feel about John Smith?
I mean, I would have to really take a look at the wow. entire situation.
Okay, that's well,
a
another
I mean,
big
I'm not trying to avoid anything.
That
I just don't want to say
a lot of the decent cops are leaving because
no,
of the vax.
There's no decent cops.
Well, I was just going to make a correction and say, no, Michael probably thinks there are none, but... Good meaning cops, a lot of them are leaving
because of
the vax.
Right, you're right.
That's
true. And I disagree with Michael on that. I think there are decent cops, but I understand your point about the institution as a whole. Mm-hmm. But I think there are, I've met cops who have been, they've actually sought to like stop violent criminals
sure.
and rapists and murderers.
No question.
And I've seen these cops be like, I'm not going to stop some kid for, you know, this, that, or otherwise. I will also correct you. You said all gun laws are unconstitutional.
Yes.
What if the gun law was that you had to have a gun?
Well, that actually was the case in America in the colonial period. And yeah. If you look it up, I have an article in
Welcome
The
back.
Observer that says must pack heat, arguing for using Obamacare as a mechanism to mandate gun ownership.
Criminals aren't going to follow the laws anyways.
Well, no, so we're talking about what... Michael had said all gun laws are unconstitutional. My question is, what if a gun law mandated you do own a gun?
Like, well, that's unconstitutional.
It is unconstitutional?
It's not unconstitutional.
Switzerland makes you do it.
I don't know,
form of indentured servitude.
Well, hold on. I don't know if
owning a gun is indentured servitude?
No, if you make somebody own a gun, that's indentured servitude.
Who are you in servitude to who?
Who's making me own a gun? I thought you were an anarchist.
I am an anarchist. The point being, it's even if I disagree with you about classifying something
if
as
if they made you join an anarchist collective to have a gun and you willfully joined it as part of a membership.
This has nothing to do with anarchism. I don't explain to me how mandating gun ownership or mandating health insurance is indentured servitude.
I mean, now you're for forced inoculations?
You didn't answer my question.
No, I'm not for anything. I'm not for forced insurance. And I'm not for forced gun ownership. I'm mad at you, Michael. I'm just telling you.
I just don't understand. Can you? Maybe this is my autism speaking. Can you explain to me how mandating someone owning a product is indentured servitude as opposed to unlawful?
All I know is under my common sense freedom and under what I want, I don't have to own a gun
if I don't want to. Let's not go in circles. Okay. I think he was just using the phrase incorrectly.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
I think the point is like, I remember when I think it was Illinois mandated seatbelts. I don't know when they exactly mandated seatbelts, but I remember having a conversation about, do you have the right to not wear a seatbelt? Well, not anymore, you don't. And then I had a conversation from there about how you're forced. I remember when Obamacare was coming through and people were like, what about auto insurance? The government makes you buy auto insurance. No one cares about that. And I was like, actually, I kind of do. You know, I of course would always want to carry insurance, but
and that's on a state level as well.
The idea that the government would mandate you buy a private product
and
then regulate that product to like guarantee
and
your
now
money
they use it as an example. Oh, you got to buy insurance, you got to wear a seatbelt, so you got to take a shot. I say, I'm more of an anarchist than Malice, I guess.
Oh, sweetheart. Oh, for
come sit on my lap right there.
No.
Oh.
You and Blaire, right?
Listen,
there.
You're no Santa Claus. I'm not sitting on my lap. Okay.
So we're playing Who Could Anarchist out the Anarchists?
My book's right behind you.
Yeah, it's right here.
Anarchisthandbook.com.
No, I watch your show. I watch Tim's. I know you're intellectual. I know you're actually genuinely smart. I respect you. I'm just saying I agree with anarchist precepts, but informing that and injecting that into the real world does not work.
I disagree.
It's scalable, yeah. Until it's been proven.
It's complete. Yeah. Anarchism isn't a location, it's a relationship. So this show right now is an example of anarchism working.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. There's a lot more anarchism than we know. Centralization is when we have government, when we have fat cat bureaucrat mafiosos coming in and saying, I want a cut of that. It's centralization. Decentralization is anarchy, in my opinion.
I'm for decentralization.
Exactly. So you're for anarchy, and I'm for anarchy, because that's the true definition of it, with no one intervening, no one forcing you to do something. That's the basic core concept philosophy. Feeds of
Can
anarchy,
say,
which should
thing.
Be respected and talked about properly. And that's why I had to correct Joe Rogan when he said this was anarchy. No, it wasn't. State-sponsored terrorism. Alex knows about that.
Give me 30 seconds. I'll shut up for 10 minutes. I promise.
That's a lie.
I don't believe that. That is a lie.
You're an effing liar.
That is not true.
You're an effing liar.
30 seconds.
I would like to give everybody
every lie detector I've just exploded.
Get a timer right now.
Yeah. Just mute his mic. Lydia, just mute his mic for 10 minutes.
No.
Get your timer ready. I want you to hear this for 10 minutes. Shut up. I actually love everybody in this room. I know you all, and I really appreciate from the producer to everybody. And this has just been historic, and Joe is so amazing, and all you guys. And Tim, thank you for having me here. You're right, it is real anarchy, and it's beautiful, and I love you all, and I appreciate being here.
My favorite thing all of this was I was like, the show started with us having Blaire to come on, and then, you know, Alex was like,
hijacked me.
We hijacked it. But the best part was the very end when everyone's like, have you asked Joe? And I'm like, he's busy. And then Joe's like, yeah, I could probably come in. Where are y'all at? And I'm like, we're in a trailer on the side of the road.
Yeah, of course.
And so he's like,
it's a very nice trailer, though.
It's like, it is really, really great. And I just think it's hilarious that, you know, was it you said it? Like a step down or something? Like the mighty have fallen?
Oh, yeah.
Joe Rogan coming from his massive, amazing new Austin studio to my trailer on the side of the road.
Joe's not an elitist. He loves you, Tim.
No, I know. I'm just messing around.
You know, he always loved you, but after you destroyed Twitter with him, he like puts you at the top tier.
You know what's funny, though, that we had beef.
I didn't know that. Tell the story.
Like for dinner?
I knew you'd like that one. No, he had pork. He had pork.
Well, so it's not too complicated. Someone back in like during Occupy era, somebody tweeted at Joe when his podcast wasn't as big. They were like, you got to have Tim Pool on the show. And then he tweeted me like, yeah, for sure, man. Why don't you come and hang out? And I said, cool. So, you know, I was young and bright-eyed and naive. And I was kind of like, this is Joe Rogan. This is back in 2011, mind you. So not the biggest show in the world.
You wouldn't come on my show.
But I didn't know who you were.
He values his time, Alex.
I remember telling Luke, hey, get me Tim Pool.
Well, so check it out. So I flew to L.A., and once I landed, he messaged me like, bro, I'm really sorry to do this to you. I can't have you on the show. Something came up, and I went, I just flew out to California. And so I made the best of it. There's some protests I covered. A year later, same thing happened. Somebody tweets at Joe, like, how come you never had Tim Pool on your show? Now it's 2012. And he was like, yo, we tried to make it happen. It didn't happen. Tim, what do you say? Come on the show. And I was like, let's do it. This time, I was like, I want to make sure we confirm this. Like, because he gave me the details before. I'm like, give me the details. Give me the time. Give me everything. And he does. And so I get on a plane. I paid for it myself because I'm young and naive. And I fly to California. And then he says, bro, I'm so sorry to do this to you. I can't have you on the show.
Oh, my God.
Something's come up. And I was just like, all right, now I'm really mad. And I was like, dude, are you kidding me? It's like a year later, you did the same thing. And I thought to myself, I was like, look, I'm obviously mad about it, but Joe doesn't owe me any favors. Me going on his show would be really great for me. So I was just like, that's the story. And then what ended up happening, I was like, I'm not gonna be mad about it because he doesn't owe me anything. And I'm gonna focus on my thing. I'm not gonna beg him. I'm not gonna ask him. And I just went about my business. And then a couple years later, Joe just messaged me and he was like, bro, I just want to let you know, like, I am really sorry about, you know, having canceled on you like that.
And now it's beautiful.
I don't want there to be any beef or anything. And I was like, nah, dude, there's no salt. There's no beef. Like, it was just like it happened twice in the span of a year.
But let me tell you about Joe in the old days. He was doing so much comedy almost every day and his other jobs. We were going to do his podcast forever and he would cancel it too. He just used to like the podcast was a side thing. And then starting about 6 years ago, he made it the main thing, and that's what happened.
I don't feel as bad now because there was two times where Joe invited me on and it didn't happen. I didn't fly out. But and then I just checked my phone before I went on. I have a missed DM from him from 2 weeks ago asking me to come on. I'm like, why am I? Now it's my fault.
Yeah, he knew who you were. He's like, oh, hi, Blaire. And I was like, well, why aren't you on the show?
Now here's the crazy
story. That was a sweetheart, though, man.
Here's the crazy story.
You
should
have seen us taking acid in Vegas.
You want to hear the Twitter story?
Can we hear about that story?
You want to hear it? I'll tell you.
I would love that.
You guys want to hear the Twitter story? Because I don't got. I
want to hear the acid story over the Twitter story.
The acid story is more important than the Twitter story.
I'll tell you a Joe Rogan story. Sorry, go ahead. You want to hear it later? I'll tell you later.
No. I would love to hear it. Well, now. Can we?
Is it something where you're like, maybe I shouldn't have brought that up because it's a story I probably shouldn't tell, or are you going to now spill the beans?
The big question is, which story should it be?
Yeah, the wild one, the crazy one.
So when you
you've seen the movie like The Hangover?
Yes.
This happened before a few times. I don't remember with me, Joe, and Joey Diaz. I just remember like, actually, you get Joe on next time, he'll tell you. But I mean. I remember, like, 2 days later, because I was not a big, you know, 2 days later, like, not knowing where we'd been and, like, in Vegas with him. Because he, like, I went out and saw some of the fights in Vegas and other places with Joey. He invited me to get me tickets. He was a great guy. And so I remember, like, okay, we're at ESPN, and we're on air, and this is going on. I'm in a control room, and Joe is whatever. And, like, 2 days later, I'm like, what happened? Joe's like, I'll see you later. I'm going on a plane. So it was pretty wild, man, pretty wild. But Joe's not like that now. But he's definitely done some partying.
Yeah,
I mean, let me tell you, I've sat there with Joe, because now we go out, he might drink like two beers, and he got in great shape, everything, but I remember, like, I mean, like 2 days up with him, and he wasn't on any type of amphetamines, it was all just Joe's energy, mm-hmm. and we're, like, drinking, like, 20 shots at, like, 4 a.m. up for 2 days, and, like, taking edibles and all this rest. I mean, this dude's, like, a thoroughbred. I mean, a thoroughbred, man.
That's why he takes the horse paste.
Yeah, that's why he takes the horse paste. So, no, but Joey Diaz once, like, we're sitting there, Joey's like, eat these edibles. And Joe's like, ha-ha, we just took acid. And I don't remember 2 days.
Yeah.
It was a huge dose. I don't remember, actually.
Any revelations, any reality-shattering moments, any kind of, like, clarity in your life through
those
experiences?
Part of it was fun, except I remember, and this is to Joe's credit, this is, like, 15 years ago, 17 years ago, this big... We're in Vegas. We're there 2 days before the fight, like a day after the fight. So we're there like 4 days. So 2 days before, 1 day of the fight, day after. And I just remember, I'm like, why don't you take the elevator to your limo? He loved his fans so much that I remember like hallucinating on acid while Joe signed thousands of autographs. Because he's trying to go through the casino once they start piling up. And I remember just like days, like hallucinating for like a day of him signing autographs. it's crazy.
Wow. You know,
see, there's like some cool story like naked chicks and stuff. It's not. It's Joe taking.
Yeah, but that's not cool. That's not the cool stuff. The cool stuff is the deeper stuff.
Joe taking photos.
Yeah.
Selfies with people. Yeah. And signing autographs.
Being selfless.
Yeah. So I asked Joe, and I don't know if he gave us like a robust answer. He gave a little bit. You know, from the time I went on and we talked with Twitter, but even before that, to where he is now, how his view has changed. And I think it's fair to say you can see in Joe a big change. So that first interview he did with Jack Dorsey was back in 2018, I guess. He was just like, let Jack say his thing and say whatever he wanted. And then he got heavily thumbs down for it. We do our show. Here we are today. And he's saying they're censoring. It's coming from the left. Yep, and that's definitive. He's seen it. I think there's two things here. For one, like, Joe really started to understand and see what was going on as things got worse, but it's also that things are getting worse. I want to make sure I preface that by saying freedom-loving individuals, liberty-minded individuals are winning many battles across the board, but in the censorship stuff, as this becomes the new corporate press, it is getting worse, and, I mean, I think the reality is we're not long for this world. You know, everyone's like, you know, I see the comments like, wow, Tim, you really pulled this thing together. And I'm like, yeah, but there will come a time. The cliffs are eroding. And over time, they are homogenizing what YouTube is. And they want it to be that mainstream narrative.
Yeah. Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah, but they know.
Eventually, the sand dumps in the sea. But let me just say this one thing, because I don't bullshit when it comes to things like this. Tim was a turning point for Joe. And I'm not going to get into our private phone calls and things. Because Joe wanted to believe in the system and wanted to believe there were good guys and bad guys. And when he remember him, I'm not going to tell the whole story, but he called up. He goes, you see what I did with Tim Poulton? I said, yeah, I heard about it. Thank you. I'm under attack. He goes, well, it's true. Joe already had all that understanding. But as soon as, so it's true, Tim, that like, you're like the vampire that bit Joe Rogan and woke him up. No. I'm not just kissing your ass. That was the point. I told you that privately. That was the
point.
But
Tim, that Jack Dorsey moment was a cornershed moment that shattered the reality Watershed. Of a lot of people's understanding of how things work online. And you were there. You didn't fall for their traps. You went around their traps.
That was like
slapped them upside their head. And then they were like, they didn't know what they were doing. So again, another thing.
Toto and the curtain.
Yeah, and something else to add here. You're saying we're not long for this world. We're long for a very long time. They can't pull the rug because if they do, they lose everything. They're slowly pulling the rug. They hit Alex, but Alex is still here. Alex is still producing his videos. Alex is getting a crap ton of viewership. We'll survive no matter what.
And we've got Timcast.com.
Yeah.
That's right.
Where you should sign up and become a member for our special members-only segments because I realized this a long time ago, but didn't really have the skills, the experience, but... The beginning of this year, I was like, if we don't have our own website, we could get plucked right out and thrown in the trash.
Exactly.
But not anymore.
Yep.
But there's also one factor you guys both missed, which is there's a big difference when you watch the news and you see that they're lying about you personally.
Yeah.
Mm. If Joe had his podcast, him broing out, talking to fighters, talking to comedians, just hanging out, you've experienced this for a long time. You turn the news and it's something that you have personal knowledge about and you see people you've never met explicitly lying about you and lies that are easily verified to be lies, that's when you realize, wait a minute, something is up, and it's happened to you as well, obviously.
You know, Tim, I rewatched that the other day, recently, you know, and what I found interesting was how the point you made, how they kept saying, we do this to protect people because if there's a threat to somebody's life through social media, we take action on it, right? And the reason why I thought that was interesting is because, like, even as of recently, after I testified in the trial, I started getting death threats on Instagram, on Twitter, all this stuff. And what was crazy on Instagram was I actually took a screenshot.
They don't care.
Of someone, of someone issuing me a death threat. I posted it. And my account
took a hit. But this is the point
I made. If it was me.
What about Kelly Paul? Ron Van Paul's wife always complains to Twitter because he gets like, I'm glad the neighbor did this. This should happen again. She's like, Jack, do something. And he's like, I don't care.
There are Twitter accounts called I'm Rand Paul's neighbor.
Wow. One of the points that I brought up to Jack and Vijay on that show was they said, you know, we're trying to protect people. There's high suicide rates. And I said, what about people with like body dysmorphia where they cut their hands off? Mm-hmm. You know, these people exist. Are you going to create special rules for these groups? I think the fascinating thing about that moment, and it comes up a lot, I guess, because for me, it was just a moment I was there and I was having a typical argument I would normally have with anybody. But I guess a lot of people didn't realize this stuff. They didn't realize, Vijaya and Jack didn't realize when they were entering this, they thought they were going to be getting your run-of-the-mill conservative going to be like, why'd you ban Milo? Why'd you ban Alex? Instead of more like philosophical and like liberty-minded questions and like fairness. Mm-hmm. And
They bled out on 10 million viewers. They bled out.
It was that and then the Sanjay Gupta thing, I think, woke a lot of people
up. That was big.
The thing with Joe. Because it was one of the very few, maybe even the only instance where you have someone who's on CNN every day lying and you have someone actually confronting them to their face, and then you go back to watch CNN afterwards and they completely edit out that interaction.
Yeah, yep.
They completely frame it as him somehow convincing Joe Rogan to be pro-vaccine.
But the crazy thing about the CNN thing was that Sanjay Gupta goes on Joe's show and Joe is like, why would they lie? And Sanjay said they shouldn't have done that. And then Sanjay goes on Don Lemon and Don Lemon says, we didn't, it was the truth. And Sanjay goes, you're right, that's all true.
Right.
That is a duplicitous, deceitful
individual. And now Gupta is a joke.
He's not a joke. That's the thing.
He's interviewing Sesame Street characters. He's definitely a professional. Yes, he is.
CNN, on average, has 80,000 viewers.
To be fair, we did like half an hour about Sesame Street last night.
We talked about it, but he interviewed Sesame Street characters on his show promoting children to get the vaccine. That's literally what CNN's doing when they're not eating human brains.
They're now targeting children, like pedophiles.
Are children watching CNN?
No, Sanjay Gupta is doing Sesame Street.
I got the shot. But hold on. But Sesame Street.
Alex the Grouch.
But Sesame Street is on HBO. Are children subscribed to HBO? If the parents are watching HBO on the apps, are the children being handed the HBO Max app to watch Sesame Street?
You think non-children are watching Sesame Street?
Non-children?
Of course it's only children watching
CNN
Sesame
Street. No, I'm asking if they're getting more than 10 children.
Yes.
When Sesame Street leaves PBS and goes on HBO, are parents putting it on and handing
it to them? No, it's on the internet. targeting children on YouTube.
I see, Tim, I promise you that Sesame Street's still very popular with the kids. Come on.
Yeah. It's YouTube children.
I think
it's fair to say that it's probably, it's reached a substantial.
Let me tell a real story.
Sure, that's fair.
I saw this 2 weeks ago and got mad about it. I don't let my kids watch a lot.
You got mad about something?
I don't let them watch a lot of TV, but my 4-year-old daughter, like Saturday's like, let me watch TV. So I give her the controller. She knows how to run it. She somehow goes to Sesame Street and I'm watching Sanjay Gupta. And I've got my phone. I go, God, I got to shoot video of my daughter standing in front of the TV. I go, no, don't do it. My wife will kill me. But this happened.
Yeah.
So, I mean, literally, yeah. My daughter Saturday was watching it. And that made me physically ill.
I got the videos pulled up here. CNN. Big Bird talks to Dr. Gupta about COVID-19 vaccine fear. Second video. Sesame Street's Rosita gets her first COVID-19 vaccine dose. CNN YouTube channel. Again, and the list goes on and on and on.
I'll tell you what the problem with this is. You know what my problem with this is? You ever see those commercials where it's like, ask your doctor if Lobestro is right for you? And it's like, even those commercials wouldn't tell you what the drug was, but they would always tell you to, like, just take it amongst yourself for private consultation. Now they're outright like, children, here's a medication made just for you. Mm-hmm. Get it.
They did an entire Sesame Street coronavirus town hall for over an hour.
There is apparently a precedent. They have done vaccine episodes in the past, but I don't think that accounts for the fact that this vaccine is different than past vaccines.
I'm embarrassed. I knew all this, and literally Saturday, my 4-year-old goes, give me the controller, and I'm sitting there on the phone doing stuff. Literally, like cooking a steak on the grill in my living room, and there's a kitchen in the living room.
Okay.
And like my daughter's watching Sanjay Gupta, and I was like, okay, I turn it off, she throws a fit. But I'm literally, it's literally everywhere, man.
Have any of you actually watched it? Are they actually like jabbing kids in the?
They're jabbing the.
Yeah, they go. So Elmo.
So what do you think? What do you think, Babylon B? Do you think this is more about visuals?
Babylon B did a joke on that.
What do you mean?
Like, do you think this is more about like visuals for kids just to see it so they grow up thinking it's normal, or do you think they're actually trying to like educate little kids?
They're not trying to educate anyone. They're trying to get the. So basically, what happens is you go to school and the teachers teach you to be docile and submissive. And then this is basically the homework, in a sense, that this carries on the lessons you're being taught in the school by the entire cathedral.
Why did the dog bite you?
because I misgendered it.
That's true.
Why did the chicken cross the street?
Same. To get to the other side?
Probably because, well, so I have chickens, and actually, I would tell you that.
There was a black helicopter chasing it down the street.
We had a hawk attack on our chickens. It was. You know, well, I mean, it was the hawk was black. I don't know.
It's a helicopter, a black hawk.
Flew over, and the chickens all ran.
Temple, you are amazing.
Why did the chicken cross the road? Oh, probably because they weren't looking to scratch some dirt and get some.
Alex, at what point would you start red pilling your kids, or do you?
Well, that's the problem. I've left my children alone, and I've got 4 children. So one's like 19, one's 17, one's 13, one's 4. But I always think of my child as the youngest one, and I'm like, that's why I feel guilty. It's like she knows how to run. Like I don't know how to turn the TV on. So I don't watch a lot of it. It's like all these. She says, "I want to put music on. I want my blah blah." She's like, meh, meh, meh. And all of a sudden, Sanjay Gupta, and I'm like grilling a steak. I'm like, huh? And I'm like greedily eating it. I'm like, huh? And then like Gupta's doing. So I go turn it off. I'm telling you, my daughter is like a demon conjuring Sanjay Gupta. So this happened like 5 days ago. So I don't know what to do.
Yep. I don't got kids. Don't look at me.
Are you just like? Do you just like talk to her like an adult? And like this is what the world is doing.
You know, I don't want to say I respect my children. I do. But it's weird. It's like I can't, like, tell a 4-year-old how things work. They see it. So I'm just like, we're turning Sanjay off now. And then she's throwing a fit, and she doesn't know why.
You know what?
But, like, why is a dude telling my daughter
Alex,
she should
take a
shot?
Alex, do you know what you do next time? I got to turn this off. This is scary. That's what you tell her.
Yeah, it's very scary.
Well, children are a lot more conscious, a lot more aware. Oh, yeah. They actually have a lot more DMT going through their brain up until a certain age. So they're in touch of the physical realm and the spiritual world a lot more than even the human beings. That's why they have such vivid imaginations because of the extra DMT that they have.
That's right. They're forming their mind.
Michael's shaking his head.
I just don't know anything about DMT.
And that's why the pedophiles want to rape them.
Okay. Well. Anyway,
moving on. Well,
Thomas Jefferson was in the Illuminati.
He was the head of the Illuminati.
what Alex talked about, which again, we're trying to be a family-friendly show, but I think that's out the window somehow. Has happened throughout recorded human history.
We are not going down that rabbit hole. That is the look. Yeah. I'll tell you what frustrates me is
racism.
I mean, to be honest, but we have people talking about your kids and the things that, you know, the atrocities committed against children, but the manipulation. We have people who keep saying that they won't stand up, they won't defend themselves because they have kids to feed. And I think it's just a remarkable precedent to see that a whole year of complying has resulted in food shortages and inflation, labor shortages, port closures, and all of the all of these people who are like, I will not stand up for freedom and my rights because I want to make sure there's food on the table. This is food security for my children.
Yeah, yeah.
And now their children are more at risk for it.
That's a great point,
Tim. I think this is the most important thing you've ever said. Or yes, we complied, not us, but the general public.
And we all did.
And it made it worse. So submitting to tyranny, being a cuck, made it worse. So what do we do?
I think there. I think when you look at how many states are controlled by, I don't want to say Republicans, but it is people who are in the Republican Party. I will point out, to be fair, in New Hampshire, the Free Staters are all running as Republicans, and they're doing amazing work in restoring liberties and rights and freedoms. So here's what I think. I think we're actually on a great path, and if you look at how many. You look at the recent elections with Pennsylvania and New Jersey and Virginia, man, the cathedral seems to be losing a lot of power. They seem to be in a full-on panic mode. You look at what happened at the FBI and James O'Keefe, and that was the act of pure desperation.
Yes.
It was such an egregious violation that even the ACLU and, you know, the Free Press or whatever comes out and they're like, we have to defend James O'Keefe because that went overboard. But the FBI was so panicked, so scared, so desperate, they made this pathetic move.
You can't. So I was just gonna say one thing. You can't look at Joe Biden as a symbol of an empire at the height of its strength.
It's true, right? So here's what I see.
He looks like a tombstone.
Here's what I see. I see good news. I see all this stuff, all this bad stuff we talk about, all the stuff that scares us, and all the concerns we have about, you know, mandates and all that stuff. And then I see people talking about a red tsunami. I see people talk, and that's only going to be good if people primary the establishment
and get Republicans. Good, I agree. Oh, God, that's so true.
But
we're
also
in trouble if we let establishment blue blood Republicans get in. If it's a, I don't care if it's a liberal or conservative, but a real populist gets in, you're absolutely right.
But I'm talking about the House, the Senate, and more importantly, the state representatives and the state senates. That trucker who won in New Jersey has got to be, in my opinion, the greatest
the symbol poster of, child.
Yeah. of victory. You know why? Because he didn't do anything. Yeah. People, Ocasio-Cortez, when she beats Crowley, it was because people were like, anything but these people again. Now she's playing ball with the establishment. But let's look at New Jersey. What's the guy's name? Ed Durr?
Ed Durr. D-U-R-R.
He spends $153 to file to run and then just shrugs. And then people are like, I'll take the ham sandwich over the Democrat.
No, I agree. That guy is the blueprint of victory.
There's two points.
Trump should have him everywhere. They should have him everywhere.
First of all, Alex, you and I are old enough to remember in 1994, the first time Republicans took Congress in 40 years. Everything's going to be different. Very little was
contract
different.
Contract on America.
Otherwise, except for a balanced budget, very few things were different. So I disagree a little bit if there's going to be a red wave in 2022 that's going to save America. Yep. That said, hold on.
I agree with you, Malice.
Of course. 100%. Thank you. But how do we make the
red wave be for us.
Alex, one second.
Michael.
My point is, the victory is not going to come as a consequence of government and elections. Victory is going to come once people realize that it's all a bunch of crap and all of this authority and nonsense is illegitimate at its core.
Did you ever comply? Because you mentioned you never complied.
I didn't have to because I was working at Compound Media. I had my so I was classified as a whatever important worker, essential worker, and I didn't do the lockdown for 1 minute.
Yeah.
I did the 2 weeks, and then I feel like an idiot for it.
Yeah. I mean, change is going to happen when people take personal responsibility for themselves. When they start taking their own lives...
No, you got to talk straight into the mic.
Yeah, it's just hard because it keeps blocking my face here. But when people start taking their own lives into their own hands and start making decisions for their families, for their communities, for their neighborhoods on a local level, that's when things will change dramatically, and they could change at a moment.
It's always
system. The whole system is based on an illusion.
Can I just say
one
thing?
It's
always best
to
stand
up. Yeah, once that lie is eviscerated... Then and only then do the establishment lose all power, and the people actually do stand up and actually do make a big key difference by just asserting themselves as free, sovereign human beings.
And here's the model. The model is gun right laws. Mm. If you're looking at Washington, it's going to be a wash. If you go to the Wikipedia and look at the gun right laws in America page, there is a GIF that goes year by year in terms
of...
We
showed it just like last week.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, we were looking at
where,
it.
Where it goes from no one has gun licenses to may issue to shall issue to
so
not even having a license. And then state by state, it overwhelmingly changed. So, oh, Alex, let me finish.
You've been talking to continually.
This is
you said 10 minutes, Alex. This is the gift.
A lot of those middle states.
Exactly. And the other thing is, this is the model that's going to happen, what's going to save America, is when this happens with regards to education. As the money goes to funding students instead of funding systems, and you get kids out of government schools, which are literal prisons for children, mm-hmm. and the only place many people experience violence in their lifetimes, the cathedral is ruined. Because all you need is 10% of the population to realize that this is all a lie.
Just look at this map and watch as all of the shall issues turn green, which is constitutional carry, unrestricted right to bear arms.
Can you explain what the colors are? It might be hard to read.
So this is so it's going to start over in a second. In 1986, no issue, meaning these states, all the states that are in red, which is a large amount, will not give you concealed carry.
Watch how they flip
in the
green.
Yellow ones, they might. The blue ones, as they're now expanding, are ordered. They must give you a concealed carry if you apply. You can see here, this is Vermont, right? That's unrestricted. Alaska, unrestricted. Now, starting around the mid-2000s, the late-2000s, we start seeing the rise. Okay, 2010, constitutional carry starts. States are now enacting laws that say you don't need a permit, you don't need to apply. The Constitution says you have a right to keep and bear arms. Texas just got this. This is crazy. Texas, actually, you had to take a license, you had to get an exam and a handgun license. Now in Texas, it's constitutional carry.
Freedom is winning. A chain reaction.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It could be a coincidence that a bunch of those red states in the middle are now green. A bunch of the no issues are now unrestricted.
That's crazy,
right.
Isn't it?
Colorado too, yeah.
Southern states said, we will not give you a concealed carry permit. Now they're like, you can do whatever you want. We're not even going to ask you. Now,
freedom is contagious.
It should also. I think the chart is also going to be the same way when it comes to homeschooling, because we're seeing a huge rise of people saying this indoctrination center, this Rockefeller created education center, is something that's destroying my child's flame. My child's life is being destroyed by this indoctrination, by this hate.
And by the way, Luke. It's almost over the top what they're trying to cause a populist uprising.
Yes.
Everything they're like, what is, it's so ridiculous.
And here's the thing, Alex, it doesn't matter where a parent stands politically. You go on TikTok and you see these educational professionals running their mouths. You're going to think, I don't know what this is, but I don't want this person near my kid.
Yeah. Yep.
There was a university professor today making arguments.
Pedophilia.
I was going to say that, but now we're saying it. He was making excuses for pedophilia as a university professor in sociology, making a video publicly, not afraid to say, hey, pedophiles are just, you know, minor attracted persons. No, they're not. They're pedophiles. They need to be called out for what they are. And trying to normalize this culturally is having a huge backlash. And they've been doing this in Loudoun County, but they've been doing this in counties all throughout the United States.
What do you make for the guy
I just want to point something out. I think it should be apparent to people why we on our show are less likely to get censored. A lot of people are just like, I don't understand how, you know, we're like, Tim isn't getting shadow banned as often. We sometimes do. And they're like, my show gets taken down and I said these things. And it's like, you know, sometimes we have guests on the show who just yell child rape out. Normally, we don't do that. We tell people, like, be careful, because the idea is what's important, not the language. And it's true that we have people who watch with their kids and they ask us not to do that. So today's episode was off the rails with all the swearing and everything. It started when I got an email and someone was like, hey, I drive in the car and listen to your podcast. If you were more family friendly, you know, it'd be more palatable. I'm like, oh, that makes sense. But then we get a lot of people and it's very obvious how I'm just gonna come out right and say it. Y'all are abrasive, very abrasive, and very hard for regular people to get into when you scream these extreme things that people don't get. When Joe told you that you have the I guess, what did he say? It's like you know stuff. So when you come out and say it and people don't know it, it comes like you're sort of blinded by what you know and what people don't. So when we're talking about stuff, and I think this comes from, you know, I'd worked in nonprofits and marketing and fundraising. If you want someone to like have a conversation and engage, and you want to make sure the ideas persist and they understand, yelling something like child rape is a guaranteed way to make sure they shut down, don't listen.
Okay, Tim, can I just say something?
Yeah.
You're right that I can be slicker. I was saying it's in the news today, all over the news.
I'm not trying to be critical.
I love you, so I understand. You're right, help me. You're right, I can teach you, can teach me. I agree. I should have said it very calmly and nicely. In Loudoun County, the young man that raped the woman or allegedly raped the woman has now pled guilty. And so it turns
no,
out...
No, he didn't.
Well, he
pled no contest.
Well, okay, well, he pled.
No contest is a no-fault submission to the court, basically saying, I'm not contesting this, just do whatever
well,
you want
I
to
defer
do.
To you. The headline I saw is that he pled to defer
no contest.
Yeah.
So no contest is basically saying, I don't want to plead guilty because then people will be like, aha, you're guilty. I just don't think I can win if I fall.
Okay, so, Tim, my understanding is that nolo contendere is regarded legally as effectively a guilty plea.
All right.
That's my understanding.
So yeah,
can someone look it up on Wikipedia?
Yeah, you like sure? beg. You say, I'm guilty, but don't hit me. It's like if you get, but all I'm saying is this. All I'm saying is this. They said that dad was a bad guy. They said he was a liar. The New York Times said he made it up. And all I'm saying is that that is now in the news that happened. And I'm sure you're right. I'm not perfect, but everybody's big and tough. People should be able to hear this stuff. That's all
for,
I'm saying.
For sure, sure. I remember a long time ago, I was watching, I think it was CNN, I'm not sure, it might have been C-SPAN. And they were out on the ground, and I can't remember, they were on the ground at some event, and you were there, and they said, oh, look, it's Alex Jones, radio host, and you came onto the camera and immediately started going, people, you gotta listen to me, I'm telling you right now! And my friends were just, they all started busting out laughing, and then they walked away, they turned it off.
Tim, you were right. Let me read it. Yeah. For no contest, it's an important legal issue.
Yeah.
So when you plead no contest, like Spiro Agnew did, I believe, the former vice president, it's a plea in which the defendant in a criminal prosecution accepts conviction as though a guilty plea has been entered, but does not admit guilt.
Yeah.
And that can work in civil court,
yes.
Apparently.
Right, somehow. Right, right. And some states don't allow
the
that.
The point is, the media said the dad made it up and arrested him. And the dad was pissed. The dude,
no, right.
The dude who was supposedly a woman went to the next place. I don't care if he's a man or a woman. I don't care what he did. He reportedly assaulted a woman. That's why I'm upset. I don't
two,
care what's, you know,
two
all.
Teen girls. Mm-hmm. This kid and one of the big things about it was they initially said that it was a trans teen, but it wasn't. Which is the weirdest thing. The teen who pled no contest is not trans, as far as I know.
Yeah, and I don't hate anybody, gay, straight, whatever. My
well,
point
that's the
is,
point too. It's just taking advantage of the laws. It's not
exactly
it was a real
covering
perverts take advantage.
No, but no, I nobody. It was a weird thing because I read the story and I don't think the perpetrator even claimed to be trans. Someone just decided to say it
to cover up.
Was he wearing a wig? Did he dress?
Wearing
up
a dress,
to get
wearing, wearing yeah. a skirt, yeah. wearing a skirt, and went into the girl's bathroom to assault a girl.
Oh, well,
so that just sounds like a predator going into a bathroom to assault somebody. You know what
but,
I mean?
But for both all you for everybody, what's the question? Why did they decide to not just burn the person that did it instead of try to cover it up? Because it came out in emails. The school's like, let's cover this up.
Because once it was a narrative that it was a trans person, then they have the incentive to protect their ideology, and they're not going to admit that.
Well, the district also had a policy that they were going to present and punch in, I think, for the unisex bathrooms, and the teachers were going to be required to address the students based off their own preferred pronouns. So they literally shoved this girl under the rug that was violated for the sake of a policy because they didn't want it to come out that this might
be a
bad idea.
It's a cult.
It's sad. Honestly, I think this is what we're talking about, why things are changing. I mean, I don't think anybody's politics is really going to like control how people view their children. And what I mean by that is your children are everything to you. And if we can't get behind protecting children and we put politics and policy over children, I think we're going to have some serious problems. This
the
is
law,
why things are changing.
Listen.
And Loudoun County,
right,
they
right,
insulted,
right, right.
And they're also insulting people. They literally said the reason why Democrats lost in this state was because it was a white lash. This was the narrative. They're insulting all these people. When if it was a white lash, please tell me how the first black Republican lieutenant governor got elected.
Oh, wait,
and then
she's
the white
nothing to do with race.
We get it. We get
it's
it.
Nothing
listen,
to do with race. But
it's nothing to do with law.
People.
It's nothing to do with law. It's nothing to do with. It's nothing to do with law. It's nothing to do with policy. None of that matters. What matters is culture. Now they will use school boards. They will use positions of power to enforce things they want. Mm-hmm. But if the culture does not agree, it does not happen. The problem is, it's as Michael described it. Most people prefer safety over freedom.
Yep.
Yep.
So what happens is
they don't get safety
in
slavery.
They don't. So here's what happens. Culturally, we almost exclusively agree as Americans critical race theory, when you actually discuss the tenets of it, what it actually is, you go to someone and say, should we segregate people in schools? Almost every single person, 99%, will say no. Then you ask them, would you be willing to go to a meeting and demand they stop doing it? And they'll say, absolutely not, because I'm scared. And then what happens? Their kids get segregated.
No, you said it. We've been bullied, and because we won't go, that's it. So what do we do, Tim? I mean, because
I was saying in the primaries, primary out the establishment Republicans, a red wave is not going to save anybody. But the Free State Project in New Hampshire, how do you feel about that, Michael? I feel like that's
a libertarian
huge.
Wave taking over the Republicans is beautiful, or Democrats.
Yeah, right.
I don't care. How about we just have a populist wave take over everything?
Yeah.
Well, like with the Free State Project, last time I brought it up to Malice, I was like, hey, are you going to Porkfest? You're like, no. I'm like, how dare you? I think we're going. I think we're taking this RV to Porkfest.
Yeah. If we can get Starlink.
We can, and I'll get it, and don't worry about it.
That
we'll
wasn't a knock against the Free State Project. That was a knock against me being in the woods.
Okay.
I just want to clarify that. I'm a big fan of the Free State Project.
Hey, Michael, we're going shooting Saturday. Come on.
Yes.
We're getting vaccines.
Different kind of shooting.
And we're gonna bring barbecue down, right? Are we bringing barbecue down?
Did I get you barbecue today?
You did. Yeah, from Terry Black.
I haven't had it yet.
It's amazing.
Blaire, are you gonna bring your pink AR?
I can do that.
Yeah.
I got
she's got one.
I'm down.
I got barbecue for you.
I want to go to the woods with you though, because I asked
Thursday
you to do that the
too,
other day.
And everything you want.
I know it sounds
we're
like
get,
a nightmare.
We're gonna go down and
if you want Rudy's, we'll get that.
We should. Yeah, we could do Rudy's.
So,
whatever.
So you think like a statewide school choice initiative is where is the next step of shattering the mold?
Sounds good.
I think we need a national free state kind of thing.
Yes.
We need people at the local level to start voting only for their local candidates who agree with certain principles of freedom, liberty, individual responsibility.
I agree. We need a litmus test for liberals, conservatives, gay, straight, whatever. Do you support the Bill of Rights, the Constitution, everybody's rights? Let's get past labels.
Who's going to be putting this is nonsense. Who's going to be putting this litmus test into practice?
They do it in New Hampshire. New Hampshire has the highest amount of homeschoolers per capita than the entire United States. They have some of the highest IQ. They have some of the highest machine gun ownership.
Stop. This is nonsense.
Machine gun.
You're full of it. New Hampshire is.
I've talked to gay people, straight people, black people, white people.
That's
they
great
all out. Want freedom.
No,
man.
They don't. You're full of shit because you saw what happened to the lockdowns. If they all wanted freedom, we wouldn't have the lockdowns. That's a complete lie.
Stop the lockdowns.
What do you mean stop
Florida
them?
Stopped the lockdowns.
Yeah.
Wait, no. Michael,
and why are you so pessimistic, man?
I'm not pessimistic because I'm thinking if you think the salvation is going to be voting in the right people, you're completely delusional.
We Alex, culturally fight at every
Alex,
level.
Alex,
voting is one aspect.
Alex, he's talking about the lemmings, the millions of lemmings in this country that bend the knee
NPCs.
To the global elite.
And to the Constitution.
And
what do we do about them?
And they don't want freedom.
You have to create systems that work around them.
So
which
Drew
means,
Hernandez, what do we do?
Which means non-democratic systems.
Yeah.
I think what does that mean, non-democratic?
Meaning systems that don't depend on getting majority of simpletons to agree with you.
No, I agree. If I'm a Republican in the Republic sense. If 51% want to enslave me, they don't have a right.
If it's 85, it doesn't matter. I don't care how many how popular it is. My rights are not up for discussion, let alone a vote. And Luke, the reason I was disagreeing with you is
so mad, Malice.
I am mad because there's a war in our minds. What I was disagreeing with you about, Luke, is New Hampshire is a self-selecting population. It's a very small population. You can't replicate the Free State Project on a nationwide level because there's a huge percent of the population, as you agree with, who do not share our values.
I disagree because if you look at just autonomy, I don't care if it's a bunch of communists wanting to live in the woods. We have examples of this with the Amish. The Amish are living by their own set of rules, without government, without mandates, without vaccine mandates, and they're doing a lot better than a lot of other people. So if the Amish
can
do it,
COVID. No,
that's not true.
No, they are dealing with COVID.
They are dealing with COVID.
But they haven't had a significant. Cheryl Atkinson's did a great documentary about this.
Yeah,
it's on our YouTube channel. It's great. They are dealing with COVID. You guys are both right, and I think you're
but
right
it's
too.
Much
at
lower,
the end of the
much
day.
Lower.
But they don't have a huge death rate like many people expect it to. Even though they have policies where they literally drink from the same cup, they have religious ceremonies where, and everyone said the Amish are going to die. The Amish are going to have a huge extinction event. That didn't happen. Their death rate has stayed the same with COVID comparatively to the rest of the population. So that's a big thing. Cheryl Atkinson's documentary is really huge here. And if the Amish could do it, the Free State Project could do it, and that's victory in itself. yourself. That's victory when people say, hey, I just want to have my own kind of life, my own rules, my own autonomy.
That's right. With tyranny, non-compliance is key.
And New Hampshire has created a beacon for Bitcoin, has created a beacon for personal responsibility, for personal freedom, from homeschooling. It's becoming the shining light and example of people coming together and saying, hey, this is how I want to live. You can live there. And if people want to be communist, let them go to New York City. Let them go to Los Angeles. They have a right to live wherever they want to.
That's what I'm saying. It's not going to replicate nationwide.
It doesn't have to be.
I have an administrative thing to say. I have an administrative thing to announce to the people listening. For the super chats, at a certain point, YouTube just starts deleting super chats. So we can read some of them, but... I just want to say that because I feel bad for a lot of people who are, you know, posting comments and questions. When you have a show this big, we had 110 plus, I think we had like 114 or 15,000 people watching
good
at
Lord.
One time.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. YouTube just basically starts erasing the super chats.
Thank you, everyone. So,
but we really give appreciate me a copy of those super chats.
But Malice.
Hail to the chat.
You could live in New York City. Rock. You could live in Los Angeles, or you could live in New Hampshire. I live in New Hampshire because that's how I choose
Luke,
to live.
Luke, I moved to Austin for this reason. Yeah. You're preaching to the choir.
The new California. But you moved to the new California where all the trendies are moving into.
The point is, you were Tim and Alex were asking how do we replicate this nationwide, and all I'm saying is you can't replicate the Free State Project nationwide because there's not enough people to make that happen democratically.
No, I disagree. We were just talking about how who was mentioning this, the primaries basically dictate how all the elections are being run.
Okay,
were we talking about this? I don't think we were, but the idea is that you get a small amount of people who will vote for a Democrat, and then independents basically don't, like, they don't participate in primaries, so they enter the election and they're like, what are my choices? Whatever the Democrat 10% and the Republican 10% voted for. What happens if you get a Free State Project of, you got a state with 1 million people, or you got a jurisdiction of 1 million people, and 100,000 are liberty-minded people who are brought together,
sure,
and they all say, we are all going to vote in the Republican primary for this libertarian, and then the independent moderates have
exactly.
no choice
it's
but to vote for our
guy. Exactly, it's that swing vote that takes over.
That's how Trump won. Yeah. I mean, on the
national it's how the progressive,
scale.
It's how AOC won.
Yeah.
Nobody actually knew what she was.
I feel like I'm crazy. There's an enormous asymmetry because when you have those two candidates, whoever that libertarian candidate is, will be demonized by the corporate press.
But that backfires now.
No, Biden won.
By fraud.
Yeah,
I think
you're right that we need a non-democratic solution.
And I told this to Steve Bannon. I'll tell you what the most...
Okay, well, he wouldn't win right now.
I don't think he'd win right now, but the most frustrating thing is...
They won two seats in Georgia.
They write an article explaining about the shadow campaign to save the election.
Right.
They talk about mail-in voting and how it gave them massive advantages over Republicans, and then you end up with this large populist movement spinning in circles about things they haven't proven in a year, and then instead of getting their ground game going and countering the changes to election law, they're going around screaming at each other about
Tim's right.
Engage Tim in a reset war. I'm trying to get people to realize.
Is there a website for that, Alex?
The corporation is creating resetwars.com. The point is, it's the biggest thing I'm doing. It's going to launch next month. It's huge. But sure, I've changed the world a lot here, so I'm not a BSer. This is big stuff. How do we get people aware of the global corporate structure, how they're mind controlling us, instead of just receiving the propaganda? We've got a big awakened population right now. How do we get them engaged?
I would say build a decentralized parallel system, and I'll give it to you also.
Yes. Well, I'll say it's do ridiculous things like this.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was like, hey, we're going to do a really, really crazy show. Navigate the minefields to the best of your abilities so they don't, you know, chop the tree down before it has a chance to bear fruit. And I will say Free State-like ideas. It's not perfect, but I think New Hampshire is doing something very, very powerful and positive. And I got to tell you, if we're gonna have any victories, like what New Hampshire is doing is very interesting and it can be done in other states, a small minority of politically active individuals can over... Like, look at the Mises Caucus. I know the Libertarian Party is not
very
big.
When Dave Smith gets 15% of the Democrat... Of the polling numbers in 2024, and I'm the press secretary for that campaign, getting 15% of polls is not impossible. And then things are really going to get fun.
And then what happens is you may be in the minority, but most people will just vote for one or the other. And if you're the alternative to the corrupt machine where people are ready to vote for a ham sandwich, you're there. So I just want to say this. Here's what I want to say.
Yeah.
So right now, one of the things that bothers me the most, we had Steve Bannon on this show, and I think he's a very smart guy. And we did a members only segment where we talked about fraud, and he's adamant in his belief. And I said, take a look at universal mail-in voting. This is why I believe there is no fraud, and I believe it's a red herring that has manipulated the populists into totally losing their standing and grounding and their ability to win these battles. Because you have, in a Democrat city, look at New York, you get one housing complex with 500 units. They all get 5 universal mail-in ballots for the 5 people who live there, mom, dad, and their 2.5 kids. The Democrat sends one activist to go door to door and hits 500 families times 5 votes each, and they can do that in a couple days, just knocking on doors as they make their way up, and they say this: did you vote yet? Your ballot is right there. Fill it out. I'll wait. Republicans have to go to rural areas where they drive through suburbs, and they can hit 5 houses on one block, and they can get 10 houses in a day.
And Republicans should focus on cities.
Republicans should focus on the rule changes that heavily advantage urban dense centers. The Republicans should focus on the rule changes that disadvantaged Republicans. Instead, what are we getting? Trump's movement, the populists, are right now, they're talking about Venezuela and China and gun battles in Germany, and I'm like, they got him. They shut him down with the conspiracy fraud stuff. And now, because Donald Trump won in 2016 with 77,000 votes across 3 states, sure, he did really well in the Electoral College, but it was 77,000 votes across 3 states. And so they said, if we can throw the populist movement off base with something that won't have an impact on us, we won't lose again. And they did it. A year before the 2020 election, the Republicans in Pennsylvania changed the law to introduce universal mail-in voting. We talked with Sean Parnell about this. He sued about this. They said, at first, we're going to create universal mail-in voting. Uh-oh, our Constitution forbids it. And they stopped because they needed a constitutional amendment to enact it. They stopped and said, okay, what do? Let's change the word to mail-in instead of absentee and pass it anyway. And when Sean Parnell and others sued over this because it was an unconstitutional change, a lower court judge said, on the merits, you will likely win. It went to a higher court who said, for it not on the merits, just for standing or for it's too late. I forgot what the Latin word for too late is. They said, we're not even going to take the case. So we see an article that in Time magazine, the shadow campaign to save the election, and they explain exactly what they did. We changed all the rules to heavily advantage dense urban centers, and then the populists got wrapped up in a fraud narrative that stopped them from.
There's a whole book about this. Let me just say one sentence, Alex. There's a whole book about this called Rigged by Molly Hemingway. Mm-hmm. I know you had Mark on the show to discuss this, so if people are interested, they can read about it. Go ahead, Alex.
No, I'm just going to say, where does this all end? We're about to be at war with China. The dollar's plunging. There's massive inflation. Let's talk about the big picture. What is the American people going to do as they realize that the design collapse is here and that all these corporate interests think we're too stupid to understand what's happening? To me, that's the big deal. Forget Trump. Forget Democrats. Forget, you know, all this stuff. We are in a major sea change right now, in my view.
Alex, I think being happy, healthy, and prepared for whatever comes next is the solution, is the real resistance.
Yes.
And there's going to be a lot of turmoil, especially economically, hitting this country. As soon as COVID happened, I was like, this is not going to be about COVID. This is going to be about the economy. And we're seeing the start of this. This is only the beginning of this. And I think we're really headed for hard times. And I think the way to resist this is by having family, is by having a network, is by having a cohesive group together that is ready for whatever happens. If you're unprepared, you're weighing down your family, you're weighing down your neighborhood, you're weighing down your community. So right now, more than ever, smarten up, look at the situation that's happening in front of you, and make sure that you are ready for whatever's to come, because it's going to be a very bumpy ride.
I totally agree with that. Yeah. We should just transcend all the arguments and realize this is a global engineer collapse.
Yes, it is.
I'm concerned about the food supply.
I think
because people love each other until they get hungry.
I'm
going to eat my neighbors.
How do you rapidly bring about equality?
Drew, you're looking pretty good right now.
We need to fix the shipping industry, because right now Amazon's got kind of a...
You'd be the first one we eat. Let's face it.
How do you bring about the equity they have said they want to bring about? It's simple. Knock everyone to zero, then there's no systemic inequality. And everyone is now destitute and poor. And then when you start over, everyone will be the same, or so they believe. We'll see.
No, I agree. If you wanted to run an actual communist system, you'd knock everyone to zero and then let their own instincts bring it back up. But they're not going to do that.
Well, see, what would happen is there are some people of skill and merit who will naturally rise to the top, and there are some people who won't. And so there's this belief among the postmodernists, the blank slaters and all that stuff,
yep,
that you knock everyone, you strip everyone of what they own, take away everything they own, and make them all worth nothing. And then when they start over, everyone will be equal. But you know what's going to happen? Uh-oh, the tall grass will start growing again. And as we know, the communist will decide you have to cut the tall grass. And they'll keep having to mow the lawn to deal with the fact that some people are better than others. And I don't mean like, I mean quite literally in terms of skill, in terms of passion.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay that some people are better than others at work. It's okay.
Literally. Sports, math, science.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of folks better at lifting weights or doing math than me. I've got my skills.
Joe Rogan is a better fighter than I am.
He is a badass. I need to recognize that he's better than me at fighting.
That's right. And so what happens when you have a society of a bunch of people and some people are just better than others?
And then you learn, oh, I'm better at this. Let me provide this to the man or woman that's better than me at this. And then we have a symbiotic relationship. Yep. And that's what it's all about.
So yes. So what ends up happening then is the guy who's better than, you know, Michael at baking cakes bakes the cakes. Because why would Michael if someone else can do it better?
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden we have a society with really awesome cake. We have great basketball players. We have great scientists. We have amazing and talented politicians who clearly... No, I'm kidding about that last one. But then people can say, you know, whoever is really good at this task can help provide that task. That's basically what we do. The postmodernist, neo-Marxist, communist, whatever this ideology, this cult religion, they don't believe that exists. So what'll happen? Well, they'll have to purge anyone who proves it doesn't exist.
Yeah, they want to attack anybody that doesn't fit into that model. Mm-hmm. But then that's the lie. They say they're in charge in the model. They say, oh, nobody's in charge but them.
Right.
And if they're not, say there's like a horrible reset where like an asteroid hit the Earth and wiped out the population and they grew back like 13,000 years ago. You see warlords. You see the people that are the best at and got there first taking power, not necessarily good. It's never been a perfect system. It's imperfect system.
Tyranny is not a conspiracy theory. And I think people need to understand that, you know, you're either going to learn through wisdom or you're going to learn through experience. And I mean, we could sit here and warn the world with absolute truth day in, day out, every single night, giving them the best coherent arguments as to why they shouldn't follow these dangerous ideologies. But it's not until they actually feel it, experience it, will they actually wake up. And I'm not talking about the people that are watching that are awake to this stuff. I'm talking about the people that actually believe what's being told to them on CNN and all these propaganda.
Drew, that's beautiful. You know, tyranny is not a conspiracy
theory. It's not a conspiracy theory. It's happened in human history. And I want to communicate to the viewers right now, we are not telling you what to think. We are telling you, think for yourself. Because if you're not thinking for yourself, then someone else is thinking for you, whether it's left or right. And that's when you get into a dangerous place. That's happening in mainstream media. That's happening in the music industry. That's happening in education. It's happening on all fronts. And right now, this podcast is for the purpose to communicate to the public, think for yourself, because that is the message that I think every single one of us
has. That's right. Don't give your will over to anybody.
Yes. And two things. Hopefully, whatever ends up happening to this podcast, it already reached a lot of people.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, what is it, millions already?
I think we probably, in total views, maybe over a million, but I won't know until we wrap and we get the full numbers.
Dude, you had Joe Rogan for an hour.
Yeah. I'm grateful, man. So
what was the peak live number, 110?
Like, no, I think it was a little bit more than 110.
110
might
have been something.
You told me when I was on was the record. Didn't Joe break it?
No. When we had you on last year, it was like 140.
That was us.
Yeah, it was so long.
It was crazy. But so the other thing I'll say is I'm gonna try and take a few super chats.
We should. Let's talk to these people.
Shout out to DMT.
I'm looking for the hard, legitimate, good questions
that can
spark the conversation. But I greatly respect and appreciate all the super chats that are saying, you know, FJB and we love the show and things like that. I mean it. YouTube deleted a lot of them, but I want to try and find the core questions that we can ask to kind of, you know, keep this conversation at a good level. And we have one right here from Hoosier Films is Malice. How do we go from the Constitution is garbage and boomer to the freedom will come through gun rights laws? How exactly will those get done legally without current 2A?
The 2A has been a very, very poor bulwark against government encroachment against gun rights, as the fact is that as a New Yorker, it's almost impossible to get a handgun. So the Second Amendment is supposed to codify your right to bear arms, but the courts can define it however they like, and they completely dismiss it. So the best answer for gun rights is gun proliferation, because once there's enough guns distributed through the population, it's literally impossible to have that bell be unrung.
Power to the people.
What about like arms in general? Like if you had like nanobots that could fly into people's ears and blow their heads, like should everyone have that weapon too?
No, only me.
Right, yeah.
And Blaire.
Like, would 2A cover that?
But that's the big question. The globalists said they're going to take over and have world government to stop proliferation of dangerous technology, which I get, but then they still have the power.
Of course, yes. Yeah. It never applies to them.
But that's the part of everything that came out of 2020 that didn't work in their favor was there were so many people who realized for the first time in their lives they needed a gun.
Mm-hmm. And one more thing. Everyone's stupid Facebook friend for a long time up till 2020 was talking about, look at Australia. They gave up their guns, and now they don't have crime. You're full of it. Look at Australia. Yep. And now I'm going to say, tell your Facebook friends, look at Australia.
Yeah, look at that.
Look at gun control. It equals total slavery.
Look at Europe. They have the most vax mandates.
I don't want to look at Europe.
They have the least amount of gun ownership.
Yeah, no shit whole country references.
So, I'll say it again, like most of the super chats are just like, I agree, or great show and things like that. And thank you all so much for the super chats because this is a huge show for us. But we have a good question here. Uncle Sam says, Tim, do you still stick to it's just a mask? Why or why not? I saw it as a cracked door to what we are experiencing now. Thoughts? I do feel like it's just a mask for the most part. We flew out here and they said you have to wear a mask by federal law. I said, what federal law? And they were like,
there is none.
And then I was like, I'm going to wear the mask. I'm not stressed about it, right? There's no federal law mandating the masks. But if a private business says we have a plane, you can fly it, you got to wear a mask. I say, okay, it's like whatever. It was 3 hours. It's annoying. I don't like it, but it's not irreversible. A private company. It's tough, right?
And go to minimallycompliantmask.com and you can get a mask that doesn't do anything but looks like it's doing something.
Well, regardless of that,
that's what I use.
I think
great idea.
We had a conversation recently.
Oh, I thought you were.
We had a conversation on the show. The CDC has like they've put out 65 studies saying masks do reduce transmission to varying degrees, and the numbers vary wildly depending on what people think the efficacy is. But ultimately, there's the challenge of private businesses can say, we want you to wear a mask, the same as they say, we want you to wear a shirt. And it's not the end of the world for me to walk into a store, put on a mask, walk out, take it off. It is, however, when the business says, you can't enter unless you undergo an irreversible medical procedure. That's very, very different.
Medical IDs and the vaccine passport is the key to the carbon tax and the social credit score. The vaccine pass, in the Davos Group's own words, is the platform and the key to their entire takeover.
Yeah, digital ID. Everywhere you go, they want your papers, no matter what.
Exactly. They could track and trace you.
And then they social credit score.
Here's a very, very important question. Matt says, Tim, who's the smoking hot babe with the sultry voice sitting next to Blaire?
Michael Malice. Oh.
Sitting next to Blaire. I love it.
This is my wife right here.
Oh, my God. Already? Listen.
Are you going to take his name, Blaire?
What?
Blaire Jones.
Blaire Jones.
Blaire Jones.
Go ahead and elbow me right here. Sorry.
There are a lot of really funny joke questions that I would love to read, but I really am trying to find.
Read them all.
No, I want to find the good questions about like what's going on and what we can answer, what we can talk about. That's actually
spark a conversation.
Yeah. Well, a lot of people are asking Blaire to do something with Tom McDonald, and considering there were many of those I've seen so far,
Blaire did a whole music video. What else do they want?
I mean,
I guess more. I guess. Oh man, trying to find good.
I mean,
questions.
I'd love to, but.
I was on Blaire's show reacting to Tic Tacs, so you could find that on her YouTube
channel. Everyone should go watch the video we just posted on my channel, me and Michael.
It was really fun. The UFOs?
You can come on my channel.
Talk about Tic Tacs, though, all these crazy people.
I want Alex on my channel.
That would be fun.
Come on, I've seen it.
Oh, Jesus. What
you know,
is that?
Alex,
it's just a stink bug.
Oh, my God. It's a bug.
Hold on. The first show I ever went on was actually Alex's show.
Oh,
I think
really?
I had like 10,000 subscribers, and I had the nice, back when YouTube messaging was a thing, there was inboxes. You sent me the nicest message. I forget exactly what you said, but it was just very nice. And you were the first show I was ever on.
So this is not a question, but it's a statement, but I think it's still a good one. Asher Litwin says, to answer Blaire's comment about prop police cars, they're often used as a deterrent in lieu of an actual officer on protection.
Oh, wow. That's smart.
Interesting. Yep. All I know is I know a guy who does that, and he said
they got burned up.
So. Well, they all got, they got burned up.
No, by my house, they got one that has like a clock on it saying how fast you're going.
Interesting.
So, I got to be honest. Not a whole lot of good direct,
Thanks for your money, Chuck.
Hold on.
Give Alex Jones.
That was $100.
I can read. Chase says, share this link, like and subscribe. Yes, please do. Yeah. But no, but yes. not all of, like, I'm trying to find the questions where it's like, you said, actually, yeah, I'm curious about why.
How about and, this? Yeah. What is the secret of the universe?
There's, you know, here's, I'm not trying to not read people's super chats, but, you know, a lot of them are like, thank Reset you for the show.
Wars.com.
Great job doing the show. You know, I came in late. Great show. Things like that. And so I really, really respect that and I appreciate it. But I'm going through just looking for.
As Tim's going through this, and as Tim's going to find a good one, I just want to thank Tim for setting this up. This is incredible. I seriously can't thank you enough. I think this was one of the most epic podcasts ever. And I just want to thank you, Tim,
what
for
you have stolen.
No, you got to do the return the map.
Return the map.
Sincerely.
Return what you have stolen. Automus. You are in great danger.
What is that Sorry. From?
Time Bandits. Luke, keep going.
Luke, speak very sincere, okay?
Sincerely, thank you, Tim, for setting awesome. This up. This is absolutely incredible and awesome.
Yes,
and it would have been important for
this
you.
And Merle Nelson says, this episode lived up to the hype. Thanks for the show,
yes,
Tim.
It
we
did.
Are all on the Discord
Sup,
server.
Nelson.
Have these type of conversations all the time. Feel free to stop by.
Give us some Rittenhouse questions.
Why did the Bible remove all the psychedelics?
Kyle,
that Jesus did from it.
So Kyle,
it's
well,
like
we got
you're doing
we
an
have a
Ezekiel,
question.
It's like you're doing an Ian impression.
Oh yeah.
even in Revelation, it's like the angel gives them something to take.
We have a question. Wait, sorry, I mean, we do have a question. It was for Rogan, but Rogan's not here. But I still think we can discuss it. Kyle Petty says, Tim, please ask Rogan what it's like being the new target for all mainstream media. Even the new Netflix special Inside Job insinuates he's a flat earther and says YouTube and Joe Rogan are lying to you. Don't know if he knows about that. Now, Joe's not here because he had to leave, but...
Did you see the SNL parody of him?
It was not
was
even
so
jokes.
Yeah, it was so off-base.
It's good to be attacked by a dying system.
It is.
It's a big sign of success.
Yes. Netflix created a show called Inside Job. Luke talked about it.
Mm-hmm.
I'll say this. I was hooked on that show. Like, I had to watch it, and it was not funny. It was not funny.
It was supposed to be funny. It was a comedy show?
It was a comedy, okay. And you'd see the beats for the jokes that didn't work. But there was one joke I chuckled at where a psychic mushroom from the Hollow Earth was talking about how he can't hang out with Joe Rogan anymore. And like, just, it was...
That's
it,
too far. We've gone
no,
too far.
It was funny. He was, I can't
I
remember exactly what
the
joke
now.
Was, but he was
one
just like...
Mushroom.
By the
oh,
way,
Joe's
do we let everybody know you're on Joe's show tomorrow?
Yeah, and this is the hard thing because that's why Joe was like, hey, I'll see you tomorrow. Like, I'm going to go on Joe's show. And I'm like sweating bullets because I'm like, if the verdict comes in and I'm on his show and we're doing like this not, so we're here in the mobile studio. I've got news. I got the verdict. The trial playing in real time. I'm sitting here doing my work because I'm like wired into the matrix.
You gotta dance with who brung you. You're gonna do his show.
Oh no, of course. I'm just saying I'll be on his show, constantly wondering like. What if it? Like I'm gonna walk out of the cave and look at the sun and see my phone.
What you're taping tomorrow at like noon?
Yeah.
I swear to God, I'll text you if the verdict comes in.
All right.
Well,
Wait, why is that?
I like the idea that only Alex will have this information. Like, somehow you won't be able to learn otherwise.
No. I'm his friend.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be watching live covering it, and then I will text him if it happens.
Okay.
That way he can focus on Joe. I'm on air focusing. I will let him know. See,
let's call teamwork, Malice. Let's take this
question. Something you anarchists don't get.
Anarchists understand.
I'm a communist. Mao Zedong, baby.
Anarchists understand being...
Lenin, Stalin.
Being independent.
Pol Pot.
And finding information on their own.
Let's, we'll take this question. This is a good one because it's based on what we're saying. Mad Anthony? Mad Anthony says, Tim, what do you feel about the judge in the Rittenhouse case overturning the jury if they find him guilty? And, we'll leave it there. Yes, I agree with that. I think that there should already be a mistrial with prejudice.
Oh, yeah.
Because the state committed a grave constitutional violation. The judge even called out, but the judge is worried.
Questioning his Fifth Amendment is wrong.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
And on the stand in front of the jury.
Yep.
And that wasn't the only thing. He admitted evidence to the jury that wasn't supposed to be admitted.
And he asked witnesses to lie. That's done.
And he admitted CGI evidence. At this point, I feel like the left is like, the judge is biased and he needs to be disbarred or whatever it is, removed from the... And I'm like, yeah, he's biased for them. And they don't even realize it because they're so insanely biased. Mm-hmm. The judge has done a fairly good job across the board, dismissing the gun charges.
I wish all judges were like that guy.
Can I say, I had Robert Barnes again. He's on my show, You're Welcome, this week. And we had an hour of him breaking down the case. And he really went to detail because I hadn't been following the case. And he really educated me. It was fascinating.
One of the most
ResetWars.com. It was ResetWars.com. ResetWars.com.
What's the name of the kid who sued CNN and all?
Nicholas Sandman.
I hope that he becomes the next.
I asked Robert about that, and it's very, very hard to prove damages, because if your damages are a trial, it's not the same as like I lost a job or I got defamed. So it's that's actually not likely, unless you're Alex Jones,
then you get a default judgment.
They would have to prove malice. Like malicious prosecution.
Oh, malice! President calling him a white supremacist.
In order to
they have to prove malice,
the state is allowed to prosecute you in good faith, and they owe you nothing if you are found not guilty. But if it's malicious prosecution, which this may be, then you can sue.
That's almost never found, though. It's almost impossible.
Right. Well, this is definitely malicious prosecution because you have all the videos, and they knew, and they tried to misrepresent.
Mm-hmm. All right. Let's we'll do a couple more. Satchel Gizmo says,
"Luke can get this one."
In an anarcho-capitalist society, how do you prevent corporations from monopolizing military power and creating a pseudo government?
Good question. That's Luke, a very
good malice. I want to give it to you. I think you're.
They have no answer.
markets do not tend toward monopoly. Number one. Number two is there's no look at NATO. There's no reason.
But militaries do.
What?
You can argue and say markets don't, but militaries take over markets.
I like the cartels, not monopolies.
Sure. The point being...
The cartels are governments.
Exactly. Right. That's another... Okay, well, how do the Mexican drug...
You're arguing semantics.
The point being that what are presented as the strongest arguments against anarchism are inevitably descriptions of status quo, right? So if your concern is that what we have now, then it's a wash. My point being, when you have decentralization and you have competition, especially in a military context, you would have these roaming coalitions where sometimes you'd have the NATO thing, sometimes you have like the Iraq war, and so on and so forth. There's no reason for it to be systematized into a monopoly, because monopolies are inherently inefficient and a function of government.
And overall, there will be less harm when things are more decentralized rather than centralized with thermonuclear missiles that are literally above our heads and satellites waiting to come down any moment when a politician loses his brain as he's carrying a nuclear football everywhere he goes. That, to me, is dangerous.
Did you say nuclear?
Nuclear football.
Okay. Oh, Michael, you need to hang out with Luke a little bit.
Yeah. I agree with you. Yeah. But the thing is, it's not how do you decentralize things without giving the decentralizers power?
Yeah, right. Like random.
What language are you speaking?
Well, like random dude and his nine buddies will have a nuclear warhead at that point.
You decentralize power, it convalesces. That's how power works.
No, that's the progressive idea of economics. Power only becomes centralized as a function of government. Look at the music industry. Look at literature. Look at podcasts and the news. Markets tend towards competition and choice as opposed to one.
Here's what we're going to do.
I thought you made a good point about militaries tending towards monopolies, because that's what stops me from anarchy all the way. I'm like a minarchist, I guess.
I've got some bad news. The bad news is actually good news. You mentioned I'm going on Joe's show tomorrow, and that means in order to get my work done, I got to wake up at 5 a.m. Mm. Yeah. So I want to unleash the members-only show and be able to just go off the rails. So all of you who are listening, go to timcast.com, become a member. This is our insulated, protective sphere of warmth where we can say literally whatever we want and swear all day and night.
And you've given them a badass show with Joe Rogan and this great crew. You got Drew Hernandez,
Alex Jones, ladies and
Luke
gentlemen.
Luke Radowski. And you got the over. Communist leader, Michael Malice.
The show is not over.
That's right.
What we do every night is after the main show live, and let's be real, like we are careful about sometimes what
you
YouTube
go to
allows.
Reset Wars.
But you go to timcast.com, become a member, and we're gonna have a members only segment of this very show where we're gonna continue the show on our website.
And Michael Malice is gonna strip tease.
And yes, I guess so.
Yeah, I guess so.
So
it'll be like that Patrick Swayze Saturday Night Live sketch with Chip and Dale and Chris Farley.
I want you to give me a powerful slug on air when we come back.
Okay. We're going to have
I'm not a strong person.
Awesome. Well, you are. We're going shooting Saturday.
Okay.
You're going, right? Saturday. Me and Tim Poole.
Awesome. I just heard about
you. I think Joe may come. We're going shooting Saturday. I'm going to have barbecue out at my ranch.
Am I
going
to be hunted for sport?
No.
Just for fun? It is a safe environment.
It is, yes. Yeah. It's have you ever shot before?
There's security. There's security on site. There's this.
Okay. I've shot
smell blood, Malice.
What?
We smell blood.
Yes, on my nose. Because I got misgendered that dog.
All right, everybody. Go to timcast.com, become a member, and help support us. Smash the like button, subscribe to this channel, share the show if you really like it. You guys did. Thank you so much for an amazing show. Thanks so much for tuning in. You can follow
the
show.
How do they do it again? Tell them how to subscribe.
Timcast.com, become a member. It's very, very easy. And then we have a huge library of members only shows where we talk crazy. It's crazy talk.
There's like a 2-hour show where Luke massages me with oil.
Oh, that's a
that's
good
not
one.
True. That's false.
In the RV. That's fake news. Disinformation.
Flagrant false advertising. Yeah. All right.
Are we going around?
Yes, we are. But okay, hold on. Follow the show at TimCastIRL everywhere. We have clips on Instagram. You can follow me at TimCast on Instagram or
and
wherever.
Follow us at ResetWars.com. Biggest thing I've done yet. It launches in 3 weeks in the middle of December. ResetWars.com. It's next level. We got the MK Ultra documents.
What's the website?
ResetWars.com.
What is it?
All right. I gotta go around.
Blaire?
I gotta be up at 5 a.m. Come on.
ResetWars.com.
Tim, that sounds like a you problem.
Blaire, how do we find you, Blaire?
I will press end stream.
Yeah, Blaire. Wait, hold on. Blaire.
Outros.
Blaire, how do we find you?
Outros. Blaire White on YouTube, Twitter, and Instagram. Just search the name. You can watch me and Michael's new collab on my channel. It's really, really funny. And yeah, just search me. I'm on everything.
And freeworldnews.tv.
Come on, Alex. Let her.
Alex, watch yourself.
I think Reset Wars is great branding. Nice work.
And Alex is coming on my channel.
IanCrossland.net. Pass the buck.
Drew.
Yeah.
That's follow me on Twitter, DrewHLive. Go to my website, DrewHLive.com. That's how you can support me.
Start oiling me.
Yes.
No.
Coconut oil.
If you want to know more about the shirt that I'm wearing and how Epstein and Christmas lights are connected, you can find out by going to thebestpoliticalshirts.com and supporting me there. And I also have LukeUncensored.com where I just launched all my apocalypse survival training videos, all of it exclusively for members. LukeUncensored.com. I hope to see some of you guys.
LukeUncensored.com.
Yeah. That's right. And thank you guys all very much for tuning in. Oh, let me throw it to Michael before I go.
You did a great job.
Oh, let's get ready to rumble.
Can we end on the war cry? Hold on. Malice and then Lydia, but then war cry.
Do it. Reset Wars.
Whoa. Let Michael promote his book.
Yes, he has to do his thing.
I'm very, very excited. AnarchistHandbook.com.
Yes.
The audiobook has finally gotten to a distributor. Tim did one of the chapters for the audiobook, so that's going to be an anarchist.
That is a sexy book.
Yeah.
Thank you. So you get anarchisthandbook.com. The book's going to be anarchistaudiobook.com, and you go follow me on Michael Malice, and you could smash my subscribe button at youtube.com/MichaelMaliceOfficial, where I also take
subscribers. By the way, you don't even return my call to come on my show and promote that.
That's not true.
Lydia?
Come on, Lydia.
All right, we're going to go. Thank you guys very much for tuning in for this super awesome in Austin show with Joe Rogan. You guys can follow me on Twitter at Sarah Patch Lids.
Do
you have more followers than Sarah Patch Kids now?
Yes.
We will see all of you at TimCast.com in a members-only segment with this very show, and we're going to just open the floodgates. Thanks for hanging out, and we'll see you there.
Everyone, war cry right now. Ready?